Hello and welcome, everyone. I'm Steve McInerney. I'm the Executive Director of POMED, Project on Middle East Democracy. Thank you for joining us for what we hope will be a fascinating look at the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia over the next 3.5 hours. Our organization decided to put together today's conference to contribute to debate and discussion both internationally and specifically here in the Washington policy community regarding Saudi Arabia. The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is, on one hand, a country viewed as having outsized importance in the Middle East, and especially as a country that is viewed as important here in the United States and here in Washington, D.C. On the other hand, it's also one of the least known, least familiar, and least understood countries in the Middle East to international audiences, including those of us here in Washington. The Kingdom has long been known as unusually closed and opaque, less open to visitors than other countries in the region, and a more difficult country for outside observers to follow its internal developments. On top of all of that, the past few years have been a pivotal period in Saudi Arabia with the rapid and aggressive rise to power of Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. And like the kingdom that he effectively rules it day to day, he is a very important figure in the region, but one not necessarily well understood by the outside world, by outside observers. For all of these reasons, we've organized this virtual conference today to bring together a collection of top experts, both Saudis and internationals, to help examine the kingdom, its crown prince, and his approach to ruling the country, as well as his regional and global agenda. In terms of the timing of today's event, I should note that we're marking the somber anniversary of a tragedy that may not have been a turning point exactly in terms of the trajectory of the kingdom domestically, or of its crown prince, but certainly has been a turning point, at least in terms of international perceptions and narratives. Tomorrow will mark 2 years since Saudi journalist and Washington Post columnist Jamal Khashoggi entered the Saudi consulate in Istanbul to take care of some paperwork necessary for his upcoming marriage. As we all know, tragically, he never left the consulate alive. He was brutally killed and butchered by a team dispatched to Turkey by the Saudi state. There's now near consensus among intelligence agencies around the world, including here in Washington, that the team that killed Jamal was ordered to Istanbul by Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. But nonetheless, 2 years later, the Crown Prince and his inner circle have faced no tangible consequences nor meaningful accountability. A number of our speakers today, including some members of the United States Congress, will address the continued need for justice for this brutal crime. In addition, today's event comes as the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia prepares to host a virtual G20 summit on the 21st and 22nd of November. Playing host to this prestigious summit seems to be a key step in the Crown Prince's plan to return to business as usual as he tries to put the brutal killing of Jamal Khashoggi, as well as countless other human rights abuses behind him, to repair and rehabilitate his international image. Numerous human rights organizations and international observers have argued that allowing the Crown Prince to host such a summit, even virtually, is simply inappropriate given his continued egregious abuses of the rights of Saudi citizens, as well as his reckless adventurism in foreign policy, most obviously his disastrous military campaign in Yemen. We'll examine these arguments and others over the next few hours. Before we begin our first panel this morning, a few quick notes about the agenda and format of today's events. We will have three main panel discussions, with the first focused specifically on the various forms of repression carried out by the Saudi state, both inside the kingdom and abroad, including the targeting of dissenting or critical voices. Our second panel will examine social, economic, and religious reforms in the kingdom carried out under the Crown Prince. And then our third and final panel will focus on the Crown Prince's foreign policy and his regional and international agenda. In addition to these three panels, between our first and second panel discussion, we will have two additional features. First, we'll have remarks about Saudi Arabia and U.S.-Saudi relations from seven members of Congress. That will be followed by the presentation of a short clip from the new documentary film, Kingdom of Silence, which is set to premiere tomorrow evening on Showtime, as well as a brief conversation with the film's director. We're excited to have a truly outstanding lineup of speakers with us today, and we can't thank them enough for sharing their valuable insights and expertise with us and with our audience. We had originally envisioned holding this conference in person here in Washington, but obviously that's not possible in the current environment. We appreciate our speakers and all of the audience for joining us virtually, Today we'll feature remarks from a total of 21 different speakers joining us by video based in four different countries and six different time zones. We've done our best to ensure that the conference will proceed smoothly, but we also ask that you bear with us in the event of any unexpected technical glitches that may arise, which we'll resolve as quickly as we can. With that, I'd like to turn to our first panel, which is entitled Repression Under the Crown Prince, Surveillance, Abductions, and Hit Squads. I'll briefly introduce our three speakers who are with us for this panel. Our first speaker will be Hala Aldosari. Hala is an award-winning activist and scholar from Saudi Arabia. She played an important role in protests against the women's driving ban and has worked to counter Saudi Arabia's uniquely restrictive male guardianship laws. She was the Washington Post's inaugural Jamal Khashoggi Fellow, and our organization POMED was also proud to honor Hala with our Leaders for Democracy Award in 2019. Our second speaker will be Yahya Assiri. Yahya is a former member of the Saudi Royal Air Force. He's now a prominent and respected Saudi human rights activist. He's also the founder of the independent organization Al-Qist, which promotes human rights in the kingdom. And our third speaker will be Iyad el-Baghdadi. Iyad is a well-known activist on behalf of Arab democracy and an expert on authoritarianism. He's the president of the Kowakabi Foundation and editor-in-chief of the Arab Tyrant Manual. In 2014, he was arrested and forcibly exiled from his home in the United Arab Emirates. He now resides in Norway, where he has been granted political asylum. I'll start off by posing questions to each of our panelists. After that, I'll turn to some questions from the audience. To submit a question at any time during this panel, if you're joining us on Zoom, you can use the Q&A button toward the bottom of your Zoom window. If you're viewing this event on YouTube or Facebook, then you can submit your question to us via email to communications@pomed.org. I apologize in advance if we don't have enough time to get to all of the questions. So now I'd like to begin with a question for Yahya. Yahya, as I mentioned just a moment ago, you formerly served in the Saudi Royal Air Force. You're familiar with different aspects of the Saudi state from different perspectives. This panel will focus on tools of repression used by the Saudi regime. The reality is that political repression, however, is not new to Saudi Arabia. The kingdom has been a closed, authoritarian, absolute monarchy for many years, frankly, since before either you or I were born. I guess my first question to you is, how is the repression and the human rights abuses that we see inside the kingdom today different from what we've seen in the past? And how is the level of repression and the nature and the types and tools of repression that are used changed under Mohammed bin Salman, specifically how they changed in the last 2 years since Jamal Khashoggi was killed?
Thank you very much. Thank you for POMED, Stephen, and for all the audience. Actually, yes, what's happening now, it's completely worse than any time before. And as you mentioned, we used to have repression. The repression in Saudi Arabia is not new. And the regime in Saudi Arabia from the beginning until now, it is dictator regime, and they used to silence people, and they used to taking people for to prisons because they express their opinion or they tried to enjoy their rights. However, why the situation changed dramatically at this moment? Because maybe the main thing in the past, the regime was trying with us to silence people and to avoid any demonstration or to avoid any demands for the rights. And there were, in the past, there is some compromise between the society and the regime. For example, if you are a human rights activist in the past and the regime want to silence you, they will tell you, you need to be silenced, otherwise you'll go to prison. And they will start to take you to the trial. And if they take you to the prison, they will give you a chance to sign a pledge and to go outside the prison. And when they arrest some activists, they will free the others. And this was clear attempt from the regime to silence the society and to make sure there's nobody can criticize the regime. At this moment, it's completely different. It looks like they are taking revenge from the people. They arrested people, they already silenced. They arrested people, they decided to be away from the activism. They arrested people because they wrote something in the past, in 2011 or 2012, during the Arab Spring. And they trialed them for very, very old stories. And at this moment, even, they are not just trying to silence people, but The torture at this moment, it's not like the past. We always have torture, but in the past is to take confidence from people, to force them to say something. At this moment, they're taking the activists to the cells for torture, then they return them to the prisons without even investigation. It's just torture for torture. It's just trying to break them without any reason, without even to take information from them. Human rights defenders, like the women rights defenders, they don't have secret information to try to take it from them, but it's just torturing them without any reason. Even the example that you mentioned, the war in Yemen, they took the decision, it's just coming as a sudden decision, without even expectation from the society, from the people. In the past, we were able to expect things from the regime. We were able to manage things and to understand the behavior for the regime. In the past, we used to say, if you do this, the regime will act like this. If you go, for example, to challenge the regime, to criticize the regime, they will take you to prison. If you can deal with it, you can deal with it. If you can't, you can sign a pledge and asking for apology, and they will free you, and you will get what they call a pardon. At this moment, everything is changed, and we can't expect what the regime is going to do. What's happened to Jamal Khashoggi is completely something nobody in the world expected what's happened. And nobody even believed what's happened, even when we heard the information. Even when the regime themselves admitted the crime and described the crime about Jamal Khashoggi, it's still unbelievable. The crimes at that moment, the war crimes against the civilians in Yemen, nobody can understand why they are still keep going with this war, why they are still holding the human rights activists behind the bars, even when they are affecting the reputation for Mohammed bin Salman himself. Yes, we are paying very high price for the activism, but even the regime, they are paying high price at this moment by keeping those people behind the bars. We couldn't understand why they don't free people. So this is the main thing, the main change. We can't expect what they are going to do. We can, and there is no limitation for their work. The torture against the women rights activists and the sexual harassment is something completely unbelievable. And when we heard, when we started to hear the information coming from the prisons, it was something so difficult to believe it until we got the information from so many different sources, from the ground, from the prisons, from the families. When we heard and gathered all of this information, we become to the decision that we must believe that. It's unbelievable, but we must believe it because this is the reality. So this is the thing that we are facing, and this is the main difference between the repression at this moment with the Mohammed bin Salman and his father and the repression before. And the main thing that changed after the murder for Jamal Khashoggi is that the regime, they have not learned any lesson from that, but the international community, they learned a lesson, because in the past we were trying to talk to the people, to talk to the media, to talk to the officials, to explain what's going on inside the country, and it was difficult to convince them. It was difficult to having them understanding the situation in the country because it was two narrative. Our narrative, it is very weak because we don't have the elements that's available for the regime. And the narrative for the regime, which is strengthened by very, very huge PR around the world. So in the past, before the murder for the Jamal Khashoggi, they success to convince people that Mohammed bin Salman is a reformer. They the international community convinced as well to be silenced for the violation. But after the murder for Jamal Khashoggi, I think and I believe it's become clear for everyone who wants to understand the situation in Saudi Arabia. And they linked all these violations all together, the murder for Jamal Khashoggi with the war in Yemen, with the mass arrest in Saudi Arabia, with the severe torture in prisons, with the forced disappear for a large number of people inside the country. They linked all of these things because who committed all of these violations and crimes is the one who presented himself as a reformer, Mohammed bin Salman.
Thank you very much, Yahya. Yahya, you were just mentioning in passing, you know, some of the women's rights advocates. And I'd like to turn to Hala. I mean, in addition to the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, another move that has attracted a lot of international attention has been the targeting, arrest, and imprisonment of a number of Saudi Arabia's most prominent women's rights advocates, which is a community that Hala, you're very much been a part of. Could you please update us on the status of these targeted women's rights activists, including the current conditions for those who are now in prison?
Yeah, well, thank you first, Steve, for having me. And as Yahya mentioned, we've witnessed really an unprecedented increase in repression, especially against women activists who have been, you know, always viewed as non-threatening as a group of activists and have been dealt with imprisonment and detention for brief durations before Mohammed bin Salman. It was quite shocking that just before, weeks before lifting of the driving ban, that wide group of women were arrested and a smear campaign came out. And I think everyone have followed that. A smear campaign happened where women faces and names were printed in media and on social media as traitors. And it has, the signature of Saud al-Qahtani, who still is free and, non-affected by any investigation. What happened is they were kept at a detention facility that is secret. They call it the hotel, during which those, at that times during which the torture happened and using ultra-investigative technique, which is described by Yahya, waterboarding, electrocution, beating, and sexual harassments. And it really is similar in accounts from, so many different women. We've heard, for instance, I didn't know that one of the women had the same experience. I thought only those women who were smeared in the media had this experience. But hearing more and more from different women who have been released or have been imprisoned later, I know that this is like a systematic use of those techniques. And what's concerning is the involvement of the State Security Department, the masked men involved in those activities who are reporting directly to Mohammed bin Salman. In fact, Saud al-Qahtani was seen in some of those torture sessions. Accounts of those torture were given to Saudi authorities in courts and in Human Rights Commission, the former Human Rights Commission, without any accountability to date. Their trials took almost a year to start, and the charges that were presented at first in the trials by media, which is treason, is completely different. We've seen in the court that they were charged with communication, basically activism, defending women's rights, being part of the guardianship campaign, communicating to several journalists, appearing in different documentaries, all the tools that activists are used to amplify the demands, communicating with activists abroad, like myself or Yahya or others. We have been marked in those charges as rogue elements, basically, which is really horrific to think of the work that we've been trying to do as a criminal. Most of those women, remain waiting for the next trial, which is never announced. It's secret trials, no representation from any legal entity. Those who have representation, they don't really know how to deal with the charges because they're not really something that you can respond to. There is no written penal code or criminal system that you can challenge, those list of charges with. The families, some of the families were harmed of those women. For instance, Aziz Yusuf was released a week after her son, who's a dual American and Saudi citizen, was immediately imprisoned. And of course, as Yahya mentioned, they looked up for all tweets. They called two tweets of his on his account, very old tweets, just to find something against him. The families of Lejain al-Hadloul, who were the first to come out with the accounts of torture, are banned from travel. Her siblings abroad are not able to get back to the country safely. And those who were temporarily released pending investigation are banned from travel, are suspended from their work. Some of them were academics. They're not able basically to access, any work opportunities or to resume their lives, let alone resume their activities. So it's a very dire situation. And the problem is the sensitization of the society inside Saudi Arabia, that there is a new reset button, basically, on what is expected from you as a society. And the fact that we're being somehow desensitized in a way not to sympathize with people, because even sympathy with those arrested could land you in prison. So there is a new norm, which is very problematic, to leverage support or to garner solidarity with those groups. Before, we were able to mobilize our community to amplify demands for release of activists or community figures. Now it's virtually impossible for people to do so from within Saudi Arabia. And you see that in Twitter, which is the main, I think Iyad will talk more about that. On Twitter, you get to see how the Saudi sphere became a tool of propaganda for the state rather than anything, which is also unfortunate, especially in a transformational time as the one we're having. One important thing, as Yahya mentioned, in the tools of repression is the excessive use of hacking and surveillance. And this is problematic also because it's in collaboration with other countries, despite the fact that Saudi Arabia has committed the crimes of torture or the unlawful acts of killing in consulates. We're seeing Israeli software, Italian software is being used to hack people. And not only the softwares are being used, but also intelligence officers from Israel are coming to support the intelligence officers in Saudi in analyzing those data, which is really problematic. You know, what kinds of guarantees that we have in bilateral relations to somehow hold governments accountable? It's just like governments act with impunity, without any kinds of guarantees that you are safe, that those kinds of tools are not used to harm people. So basically, this is the situation that we're in, and I'm sure Iyad will talk more about targeting and surveillance.
Thanks very much, Hala. Yeah, I mean, Yahya mentioned how when many of these new tools began to be used, that it was shocking to the society. You met lots of the reports, really shocking to Saudi citizens to hear of the new ways that the government were treating their own citizens. And as you describe, unfortunately, it's sort of tragic to hear that some people in Saudi society are in some ways becoming sensitized and no longer shocked in the same way that they may have been just a couple of years ago. I'd like to turn to you now. Now, unlike Yahya and Hala, you're not from Saudi Arabia. You're not a citizen of Saudi Arabia. You're a Palestinian who grew up in Kuwait and has lived in the United Arab Emirates and is now sought refuge in Europe. But nonetheless, despite the fact that you're not a Saudi, you have been targeted directly by the Saudi regime. Could you tell us a little bit about that experience, your own personal experience of facing direct threats by the powerful Saudi state? Could you also provide a bit of context? Well, what is it about yourself and your work that you believe caused Saudi Arabia and Mohammed bin Salman to view you as a threat and to take concrete actions against you?
Thank you, Steve. I think we'll have to zoom out a little bit to describe the context. So Mohammed bin Salman's rise really starts when after the death of King Abdullah in early 2015, and he becomes a deputy crown prince and the minister of defense. Before this point, the Saudi public sphere, especially on Twitter being a very important tool, because it was the free speech medium for a lot of Arabs, not only in Saudi Arabia, but across the region. The Saudi public sphere kind of survived a purge that happened in 2014. I was a victim of that 2014 purge myself. I ended up in prison and ended up being exiled. But the Saudi public sphere largely survived. It was really with the rise of Mohammed bin Salman, especially in 2016, after Vision 2030 was proclaimed in April of 2016, that we've seen a structural change, a really worrying change in the public sphere. And we came to understand that Mohammed bin Salman and the people who advise him are keenly interested in silencing the Arabic language public sphere. So it was not only a war. I mean, note, for example, that Hala mentioned Twitter, and she also mentioned the hacking surveillance activities of the Saudi regime. Note that most countries, when they have hacking technology, they use it to attack other countries' infrastructure. So for example, you would see Israeli hacking technology used to hack, nuclear sites, for example, in Iran. You see North Korea, for example, using its hacking technology to steal, basically just steal a lot of money. In Saudi Arabia, as an example, you have them using the technology squarely and mainly against their own citizens. And this is a qualitative difference that I think we have to keep in mind. So in 2017, that's when I became keenly aware of the fact that I am being watched, at least my online activity was being watched. This, of course, came on the back of certain threats that I received in 2016, which prompted me to contact the Norwegian intelligence and tell them that I perceive that there's a threat, which they confirmed. It was in late 2017 there was kind of an escalation. Many of your listeners might be aware, in September 2017, August 2017 is when Jamal Khashoggi decided to self-exile. And September 2017 is when there was a large wave of arrests in the Saudi space. One thing that was in common with everybody who was arrested, almost everyone who was arrested, is that they had a strong and very popular platform on Twitter. We actually tabulated the full follower base of each of these people who were arrested, and it's in excess of 44 million followers. So they, in one stroke, they caused immense damage to the public sphere by removing so many influencers from the public sphere. And of course, this was happening within a campaign where they were creating their own influencers and creating their own fake activity, which continues, unfortunately, to the day. And so my own perception of threat really started back then. But keep in mind, if you want to look at the global context, late 2017, and this was around the time the Ritz incident happened in November 2017. But then most people, unfortunately, a lot of people, especially in the West, unfortunately, really wanted to believe that Mohammed bin Salman is the reformer. They really were invested in the myth of the liberal reformer who's coming to civilize us savage Arabs. Unfortunately, this is the fact. I remember March 2018 was especially a dark period because his PR, this is when he did this tour, kind of a victory lap in the United States. He was received as a hero. He met with a lot of celebrities. And we were trying to do our best to communicate to the world that this is going to end really, really, really badly. Unfortunately, like I said, there's a lot of investment in the idea that, this is the guy who's going to reform the region, not only Saudi Arabia, but the region. It was presented as a model, not only for Saudi Arabia. There was supposed to be a model that's to be replicated across the region. As it is with authoritarians, with dictators, when you give them a chance, they take it as permission. And so right after coming back from the United States, that was a stretch of time over that summer when a lot of really shady, really dangerous activities were being planned. We believe that Jeff Bezos's phone was hacked in May of 2018. May of 2018 was also when the women's rights activists were arrested. And of course, October of 2018 was the Jamal Khashoggi murder. So this is the broad context. I became aware that I'm personally targeted in a way more than simply surveillance in October of 2018, shortly after the Jamal Khashoggi murder, when I received a tip, which indicated that, I'm on a shortlist. At the time I had started working. So Jamal Khashoggi was a friend, especially during the last few months of his life. And we started working on certain initiatives. And one of those initiatives was, at least two of those initiatives were targeting the Arabic language public sphere, especially on Twitter. And one thing we were doing was monitoring the disinformation output of the Saudi regime in order to analyze what they care about, kind of try to reverse engineer their thinking from the propaganda output. And we did that keenly during the immediate aftermath of Jamal Khashoggi's murder, even though, he was no longer with us. And that is when we realized that something really strange is going on with the relationship between Jeff Bezos and Mohammed bin Salman. When later in January of 2019, Jeff Bezos confirmed that he's being blackmailed, we kind of packaged all of the information that we had and we put it out there. And very quickly after that, we were contacted by Jeff Bezos' team And we worked directly with them to build a case, to kind of help them understand and also to gather evidence. Of course, they had evidence on their, they had forensic evidence on their end. And it was during this time that I think I was mostly in danger. This was a time in which I knew very keenly that they had their eyes on me. I knew that I was, you know, I was being mentioned in conversations between Mohammed bin Salman and Saud al-Qahtani. But at the same time, I had no proof. So there was no way for me to go to the Norwegian intelligence and tell them, you know what, I'm in danger and you need to protect me. That came later in April of 2018, of 2019, when, you know, I don't know how this happened, but it was the CIA that reached out to the Norwegian intelligence and gave them a tip saying that this person is, there's a plot against him. And that's when I was placed under protection by the Norwegian authorities and continue to be. Of course, how does it feel when you choose this kind of career, let's say, if you can call it that, you're already accepted a certain level of risk. So it doesn't really feel like fear, but rather like anxiety. And you kind of, you know, rearrange your life around it. But really, to be honest, once it was out in the open and everybody knew that, you know, and the Norwegian intelligence knew, and I'm, you know, receiving police protection, I was actually more safe. I'm safer if the you know, if the institutions around me are aware of this. And frankly, if Mohammed bin Salman and the authoritarians of the region did not want me dead, then I'm not doing my job.
Thanks, Iyad, for your sort of, you know, powerful kind of description of your own experiences, and one that many, so many in our field, so many activists around the world and across the Middle East share that this sort of experience and this sort of risk. I'd like to pose another question to Yahya, and then after that, I think we turn to some questions from the audience. We have a lot of questions already coming in from the audience. Yahya, Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman often presents himself to Western governments, including to the United States government, as an important partner in the fight against terrorism and the fight against extremism in the Middle East. But I was reviewing the most recent annual report by Al-Quds, the human rights organization that you founded. And one issue that your report highlighted is the law on combating terrorism and its financing that has been issued by decree since Mohammed bin Salman took control as Crown Prince. This law, as you all describe it, defines terrorism in extremely vague terms and does not require the use of violence in order to characterize an act as a terrorist act legally. In fact, it categorizes a wide array of nonviolent acts as terrorism, including disturbing the public order and endangering the national unity of the state. Could you comment briefly on the impact of this law on the rights of Saudi citizens, and also the impact of this type of law on the real genuine fight against acts of terrorism, which do pose a threat?
Okay. Please allow me to start to quote from the Special Rapporteur for the Human Rights during fighting the terror, the Special Rapporteur for the Human Rights Council. She said, Saudi Arabia, they are using the specialized criminal court and the anti-terror law to fight the freedom of speech. And by using the court and the law against people, they express their opinion, they are encouraging the violence rather than and the extremism rather than enhancing the free of speech and limitate the extremism. So the Saudi regime, they are not doing that by mistake. They mean it. And we can take some examples. Walid Abolkhair, the known human rights defender, they trialed him in front of the specialized criminal court, and they used against him the anti-terror law. And the same thing happened for several human rights defenders, including Khalid Al-Umair, Mohammed Al-Atabi, Issa Al-Makhifi. Several human rights defenders, they tried in the specialized criminal court, and they used the anti-terror law. And also in the anti-terror law, in Article 30, they mentioned, they said, criticizing the king or the crown prince in their justice, this is terror act. and people they could face from 10 to 5 years in prison because they criticized the justice from the king or the crown prince. So it was very clear, it is for political act, you'll find yourself in the specialized criminal court and judged by the anti-terror law. Several human rights defenders at this moment, they are in prison, like Walid Belkhair. I mentioned Walid Belkhair. They sentenced him for 15 years in prison and 15 years travel ban after he's serving the prison time, and 1 million fine against Walid Belkhair. One of the main crimes in Walid's court document, he communicated with foreigners to abuse the reputation or to affect the reputation for the country. And they mentioned in the details, Walid, he spoke to BBC and he talked to the BBC TV. They asked him a question about a report published by Amnesty International. And he commented, he said, the report from Amnesty is completely true and I am supporting this report. And because he supported the report from Amnesty International in BBC TV, they said foreigners about Amnesty and BBC. Some foreigners, when they have seen these crimes against Walid Belkhair, they will believe he contacted intelligence agency or someone against the country. They will not understand that's interview with BBC in front of everyone commenting in Amnesty report. Also, Mohammed bin Salman himself, he said to the in one of his interviews, he said he have evidence against the women rights defenders. They contacted foreigners and he contacted enemies for our countries and they get paid for that. And he said he have the proof and he have videos for that. Later on, he said he knew nothing about the story. He knew nothing about the crimes for the human rights defenders. And he said, this is case, it's in front of the court, this is not my issue. So he changed his words. And when they arrested the human rights defenders, all the news outlets inside the country, they described them as traitors, as Hala mentioned that before. And later on, in the crimes, we have seen most of the crimes, it's about their human rights activism. And it's clearly was, the crimes was like writing CV for human rights defenders. So by saying they contacted Amnesty International, they contacted Al-Qaeda, they were in touch with Hala Dosari to write a report about human rights defenders. They were in touch with Yahya Assiri to give him some information about prisons. So it was activism from the human rights defenders. And they put it as a crimes and they deal with it like they are a terror group or a group against the country or against the people inside the country. So they used this anti-terror law widely, not to fight the terror, but to fight the freedom of speech.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah. That's sort of very helpful, and you know, but of course, you know, quite chilling and concerning at the same time. At this point, I'd like to turn to some questions from our audience. I'd also like to remind everyone in our audience that if you'd like to submit a question, you can do so on Zoom in the Q&A box or by email to communications@pomed.org. Let's see. But I'll also add the caveat that we may already have more questions submitted than we have time to get to. So I'd also encourage our panelists to try to be as brief as you can in your answers. We'll try to get to as many as we can. I'd like to pose a question to Hala that comes from the audience. It says, as a Saudi citizen, kind of, what would you like to see the United States and other countries do to push the Saudi government to end the kind of repression that you all are describing in vivid terms against journalists, activists, and human rights defenders? I would also add that this is a question that will come up again in the third panel later on, but Hala, if you could start with some initial thoughts on this question. Thanks. attacks?
Well, it's a very good question. And most of the people think that we're trying to seek help of the international governments, basically from international, from allied governments to support our causes. But that's not necessarily true. What we call for is for those governments to stop enabling those autocrats, those unlawful leaders. Those leaders are eager for securing their legitimacy by forging those types of alliances, by using the tools that we've mentioned in the discussions, the propaganda, the platforms on social media, the and of course Twitter and Facebook have deleted thousands of accounts related to the UAE, Saudi Arabia, and Egypt. But at the same time, we're looking for more actions that is within those governments boycotting arms, for instance, that would really change the game in the region for the people. The Yemeni people can actually breathe a little bit if, you know, UK, Germany, France, the US, or the main arms, basically, manufacturers would stop selling arms to Saudi Arabia, regardless of which other countries could supplement. But that's more of an ethical cause, because they could be complicit in those kinds of atrocities if legal actions is taken, and it can be taken. Strengthening the international law and respecting the international law is another issue as well. What is the actions, you know, that international law can affect if someone is killed in an embassy in a foreign country? This is something we've seen the Turkish authorities, for instance, using this case more to manipulate the Saudi regime more than actually to affect justice or to basically reach justice. And you get to see that, you know, propagated, you know, for instance, there is evidence that Iyad, Omar Abdulaziz, Yahya, others are being hacked. Are those governments trying to protect their own residents? The US, for instance, after the killing of Khashoggi, what did the US authorities have enacted to protect the safety of their own residents or asylum seekers or whatever? These are actually thoughts for leaders to really portray the values of international law, respect for human rights, which are largely absent. We're seeing a deprivation of respect for human rights or the people basically wishes, and it fires back. It fires back in Egypt and the revolution in Syria. These policies that are given prime importance to forge alliances with leaders regardless of their crimes against their own people, and consider those types of actions as irrelevant to the international community or are irrelevant to the interests of the allied governments, is of course misleading. And I think Dr. Madawi has written in her new book about that extensively, because it comes back and it hits the business, as it happened in Jeff Bezos, for instance, case demonstrated in several issues in the legality of being complicit in crimes, in war crimes. In other instances, we didn't see that the problems of those regimes are confined to their own people, but more so there is enough evidence to show that really it goes beyond their own borders. So yeah, there are a lot of things that can be done to show respect for human rights, to stop enabling leaders rather than to support the people in their own quest for democracy and change.
Thanks very much, Hala. That's very helpful, and certainly, you know, I couldn't agree with you more that unfortunately, sadly, a lot of Western countries and Western democracies far too often play a critical role in enabling, you know, the abuses and repression that we see in Saudi Arabia. I'd like to pose a question to Iyad. Iyad, you know, you've been a prominent Arab voice aligned with the Arab Spring uprisings that swept the region nearly a decade ago, when Arab citizens courageously took to the streets to demand justice, rights, and meaningful political change. From your perspective as someone committed to liberty and rights across the entire region, how do you see the importance or the significance of the repression that we see from Mohammed bin Salman specifically?
Well, that's an important question. And I think to answer that, well, again, I have to zoom out a little bit. You noticed with Yahya's first comment, he mentioned what he described really is a broken social contract. What he really described is that the Saudi citizens could rely upon their government to deliver certain services. There is a certain, you know, kind of agreement an unwritten agreement between the people and their government that was frankly broken. It was kind of like, and this is what the Arab Spring really is. The Arab Spring is really a culmination of a very prolonged legitimacy crisis that is not only in Saudi Arabia, but across the region. The whole regional order of dictatorship has had a legitimacy deficit or legitimacy crisis that kind of exploded in late 2010, early 2011. And people who are aware of my work are aware that I do not see the Arab Spring as an event that happened in 2011, but rather as a phase. It's a transition. It's a 30-year process, and we're only 10 years into it. So before this, the ruling social contract in the region was, we give you jobs and education, and you shut up. After 2011, it became just shut up or we kill you. It became just like Yahya said, it's torture for torture's sake. There's no upside. In many cases, of course, different countries, of course, like people, their citizens' experiences in different countries would differ. MBS, his rise was really situated in 2014, 2015, when we had the initial uprisings, the first wave of uprisings. Of course, we saw another wave of uprisings in 2019, the end of 2018. But then the first wave of uprising kind of hit a wall around 2013. That's when a counter-revolutionary axis led by Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates kind of reorganized and started a very aggressive campaign to reclaim the narrative, but also to reclaim order in the region and to kind of recast the region in their own image. And, you know, really what they want is to preclude any democratic transition at any cost. So Mohammed bin Salman was the answer to the Arab Spring. If Mohammed bin Salman did not exist, they would have had to invent someone to fill his place, to fill that role. Someone who presents himself as the liberal reformer, the reformer who can reform the region without political rights, without human rights, without democracy, without civic engagements, without political rights. That was, in summary, what Mohammed bin Salman really presented beyond the region. He was a model that had to be replicated, not only Mohammed, the reason why we had to make sure that he fails in Saudi Arabia is because had he succeeded in Saudi Arabia, he would have been a model that's replicated across the region, across 22 countries or more, 400 to 500 million people. And so that was the significance of the rise of Mohammed bin Salman. He was a model. He was the idea that, you can't get a democracy for your region, but you get Mohammed bin Salman, and he's kind of just as good. For this reason, when Mohammed bin Salman crashed, of course, by his own stupidity and by his own arrogance, it was an important moment. And I think I remember, Steve, when you were introducing the panel, you said that, maybe Jamal Khashoggi's murder was not a turning point. I actually believe it was at least a delayed turning point, mainly because, I've heard there are like whistleblowers who would get in touch with me and say, what was before Jamal is not like what's after Jamal. We can't sit on the fence anymore. But also importantly, for his international image, his idea, his this promise that he's selling to the world, saying that, I got this, I'm the one who can fix this region for you, that completely crashed and failed. And this is, generally speaking, what this does is that it shifts our activism as political activists and human rights activists in the region, who are looking at the entire region, not as looking at the region as an organism rather than as individual parts of it. We have to shift right now to building alternatives to dictatorship, because the main impediment towards the future is that those dictators destroy all native alternatives. They destroy the civil society and political rights, etc. In order to say that we're the only ones you got. They don't have to prove that they're the best things, but they have to prove that they're the least bad option or the only option. So this is his, this is really, frankly, this is his significance.
Thank you. Let's see. I have a question. The question from the audience, it's submitted by Lauren Danforth. The question is, what is the role of artists like Ahmed Matar and Abdul Nasser Gharam in promoting human rights in Saudi Arabia? Yahya, I don't know if you would like to briefly answer that question.
Yes, Ahmed Matar and other artists in the country, they don't have the opportunity to support the human rights. They are not allowed to do that. Even if they want to do, they will face a trial, they face prison and torture like others. So we are not expecting things from them. And everyone working at this moment inside the country in any field, like Ahmed Matar or any artist or any in any field, they must not just listen to the regime, but even supporting the regime by somehow. Otherwise, they will face the difficulties like the human rights defenders. One famous or the most famous lawyer in Saudi Arabia, he used to work with the government, Dr. Ibrahim Al-Mudemir. He just a lawyer, and he defended human rights defenders within the Saudi law in front of the Saudi courts. So he never wrote anything against the regime. And they arrested him with the human rights defenders. They tortured him. They freed him later on in temporary release after torture, after threats, after all of that, just because he defended people in front of the specialized criminal court. So you don't need to be activist to be in prison. We are not expecting or we are not asking any support for human rights from people like Ahmed Matar or others, because we know that will take them to the prisons and will put them under risk.
Thank you. We have a number of questions. You know, Hala, I asked you just a moment ago, there was a question from the audience about what the United States and international you know, countries can do to help support human rights in Saudi Arabia, and you gave a number of eloquent, important points. So we have a number of other questions kind of in the same vein. Maybe I'll group a couple of these together. We have a question from audience member Rashine Sarna, who asked, should the United States or other countries boycott the G20 summit to send a strong message?
Of course, the whole idea of Saudi Arabia is seeking to host those summits, seeking to be you know, the site where women tournament in golf, where women, where Saudi women aren't able even to enjoy that, you know, and to seeking to host conferences like on a global level rather than on a local level. The whole idea is to legitimize Mohammed bin Salman as a leader, as a reformer, as someone who's opening up the country. And we should deny him this opportunity until something, you know, is reformed, until something happens, until those people who were arrested are released, those political prisoners are released, until this kind of, you know, mixed messages is somehow cleared out. And of course, you know, the simplest thing is to take a stand and say, we're not going to participate in this campaign of improving the image or, you know, furnishing the image of Mohammed bin Salman in international media and in the world at large. The world isn't only the media, but it's also the artists, as Yahya mentioned, it's the sport people. The sport washing and art washing is very obvious means by which those autocrats are trying to legitimize their own leadership. And as Yahya said, many of those artists aren't only able to remain silent, Saudi artists, but also it's a solidarity for them. I mean, not only for the activists or political prisoners. Those artists are denied the platform, the independent platform that they used to work with. Their work sometimes amplified the voices of the people. For instance, some of them have been forced to cooperate with the regime, like Ahmed Matar, who has been part in the China, you know, historical basically visits of Mohammed bin Salman. Everything that he's done is, of course, historical. But basically, you know, he had a special artwork called the Silk Road, you know, featured by Ahmed Matar and presented to China as a sign of the strong bilateral relations. So you get to see this kind of use of those names who have made, you know, for themselves reputation, global reputation and recognition as means and tools to amplify Mohammed bin Salman's image. And, you know, the least that the world can do is to deny Mohammed bin Salman this kind of opportunity and to hold him accountable for those types of abuses.
Thanks very much. We have just about 5 minutes left in this panel. We have a number of questions. We'll try to go through some as quickly as possible, maybe just try to get some short and concise answers to some of the remaining questions. I'd like to pose a question to Yahya. This is from the audience. It says, can you provide any background or explain why Mohammed bin Salman removed Prince Fahd bin Turki, who served as commander of the Saudi-led coalition in Yemen, of his position in September? The stated official reason was corruption, but as we know, corruption is used as an excuse by this regime.
Yeah, actually, we don't know what's going on because we just have one narrative, the narrative from the regime, and we don't have independent, not just organization, but even we don't have independent media to tell the truth and to know the reality. But Mohammed bin Salman, he widely used the war against the corruption or fighting the corruption to fight his enemies and to fight his the people maybe he don't like. So he used the name of corruption, like when they are used the name of terror to fight people.
Thanks very much. Iyad, I'd like to pose a question to you. Admittedly, this is perhaps a big question that we could have a whole panel on, but just kind of your quick initial thoughts. We have a question from the audience as to how would you compare the repression in Saudi Arabia to that by other regimes in the region, in the Arab world?
This question is a really interesting question, though, and it has come up recently in conversations that I've been having with especially with Israeli figures about the normalization agreements between Israel and the United Arab Emirates. And you know, we know that Saudi Arabia is probably on route there as well. When I commented that these are probably the worst dictators on the Arab scenes, and people would question that. They're like, you know, what about Assad? What about the head count? What about the body count? What about the people in prison, etc.? And they could make a case saying that, you know, a dictator is terrible mainly because because of how many people he kills or how many lives he destroys. And this is definitely a point worth considering. I mean, it is a matter of how much suffering they cause. But frankly, there's another factor that we really need to consider, which is sustainability, which is I would believe that a dictator who has the support and the resources to make his own dictatorship or his own model of dictatorship sustainable through immense wealth, through excellent relations with the West, through the assistance, the technical assistance of other states, etc., is probably more dangerous because we're not talking only about murdering people wholesale, but we're also talking about still being able to present himself as some kind of liberal reformer or some kind of force for change or force for good in the region. So I believe that one of the most important things to consider, like when we compare Mohammed bin Salman's repression to, let's say, the Iranian regime or the Syrian regime, we have to consider the very important distinction that the United States is not a close ally of Assad or of Khamenei's regime, but it is a strong ally, historical ally of Saudi Arabia. And this makes it so much more jarring that a country such as the United States, which frankly does not have the best record when it comes to its foreign policy in the Middle East, there's enough Americans who are horrified, absolutely horrified by what's happening in Saudi Arabia. And yet Saudi Arabia continues to have this excellent, we don't have to speak a lot about what's happening from the man in the White House because, the administration, the world government that is most capable of holding Mohammed bin Salman to account is currently his biggest enabler.
Thanks, Iyad. I'm going to pose one last question from the audience. We have a question, what, if anything, can people outside of Saudi Arabia do to prevent Mohammed bin Salman from becoming king? And is this a realistic possibility? Once again, I realize this is a big question, and I think this is a question that our next panel also will hit on. But maybe Yahya or Hala, if you have just very quick initial thoughts on that before we turn to the next part of our program.
Well, simple thing is to stop participating in the campaigns of Mohammed bin Salman to promote himself as the leader. The boycott campaigns of G20, for instance, the sport washing, the art washing, These are all campaigns, and basically to support the people of Saudi Arabia who are trying to raise their voices, to show solidarity with those imprisoned. Basically, those are the main issues that would be very much beneficial in the position of people to challenge their own governments and issues of arms sales.
Great, thank you. And Yahya, final word from you. You have thoughts on that question?
Yeah, I just ask people, first thing, don't believe the narrative coming from the regime, because you can't hear the society what they are saying, because you don't know. You can't judge society. They don't have their freedom of speech. You can't judge them and try to make yourself like you understand them. What I faced and I have noticed several times when I, in Europe here and different places in the world, they told me always, your people is conservative, your people are happy for Mohammed bin Salman. And the question always, how can you know they are not free to express their opinion? So please don't believe the narrative coming from the regime. Don't judge our society. And the third thing, human rights, it's for everyone. Don't believe it is just for the people living in the Western country and our people, they don't deserve it. Everyone deserves the human rights.
Okay, thank you so much. Although we do have more good questions, and personally, I would love to hear further from our panelists. I'm afraid that's all the time we have for this panel. Thank you once again to our excellent panelists for their valuable insights. Next, we will have remarks from some members of the United States Congress who will voice their concerns with the trajectory of Saudi Arabia under Mohammed bin Salman, give some of their thoughts on the state of the U.S.-Saudi relationship, and also comment specifically on the tragic murder of Jamal Khashoggi, which occurred 2 years ago tomorrow. We have a really outstanding group of seven members of Congress from both the House and Senate. And I believe we will start with remarks from Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia.
Hello, everyone. Senator Tim Kaine here. It's now been 2 years since the Saudi regime brutally murdered Virginia resident and Washington Post journalist Jamal Khashoggi. Justice has still not been served. A sham legal process has unfolded in Saudi Arabia, and the masterminds of the murder remain free. President Trump has not only dismissed evidence of Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman's responsibility for the assassination, he has even cozied up even closer to the immoral regime, selling it weapons for its disastrous war in Yemen and putting our country's nuclear know-how in its hands. And recently, we learned that President Trump bragged about protecting MBS from Congress after our own intelligence agencies concluded that he ordered Khashoggi's murder. Let me be clear. We will hold Saudi Arabia to account for these heinous crimes until we see a dramatic improvement in the nation's treatment of journalists and political dissidents. This includes Virginia resident Salah al-Haider and his mother Aziza al-Yusuf, and many others like them, who the regime arrests simply for advocating for women's rights. This is what is right, and this is how we honor the legacy of Khashoggi, who wanted to expose the fear, intimidation, arrests, and public shaming of people who dare to speak their minds. Thank you for inviting me to offer these thoughts on a most important topic today.
Hi, I'm Chris Van Hollen, and I'm proud to represent Maryland in the United States Senate. And I want to thank the Project on Middle East Democracy for all your good work, and especially for bringing us together today as we work to hold the Saudi regime accountable for its wrongful conduct, and especially to hold the Crown Prince, Mohammed bin Salman, MBS, responsible for his violation of human rights in Saudi Arabia, for the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, and for the disastrous war in Yemen. Now, under any normal circumstances, an American president, Republican or Democrat, would at the very least let the country know, let Saudi Arabia know, that we disapproved of these actions. But instead, we have an American president who has cozied up to dictators, and in the case of Saudi Arabia, worked to cover up MBS's complicity in the murder of Khashoggi. So we have our work cut out for us, because America has not only been respected in the past because of the power of our military, but because of the power of our example. And while we're not perfect, we have worked to stand up for human rights and democracy and the rule of law. And you have no credibility if you only apply those standards to your adversaries and enemies. You have to apply them with other countries with whom you have working relationships. But this administration has forfeited that responsibility. And so we have to work hard to restore it. Otherwise, friends and foes alike will believe they can literally get away with murder. We can do much better than that.
Hi, POMED. It's Tom Malinowski. Thank you for having this event, and thank you for advancing the very simple proposition that our relationship with Saudi Arabia should be based on our interests and our values. It is not in our interest, I'm sure everybody in this meeting agrees, to allow any country, even a country that's a partner of the United States, to feel like it can get away with kidnapping and murdering a journalist who's based in the United States. We still don't have accountability for the brazen murder by Mohammed bin Salman of Jamal Khashoggi. And I don't believe that our relationship with Saudi Arabia can ever be right, can ever be consistent with our interests and our values until we have real accountability. There is bipartisan agreement on that question in the US Congress. We have repeatedly passed legislation that tells this president that we need a different approach. In a few months, I'm pretty confident we're going to have a new president. We're going to enact that legislation. We are going to have a relationship with Saudi Arabia that actually is consistent with what we stand for as Americans. Thank you for all the work that you're doing to bring that about, and look forward to continuing our work together.
Hi, I'm Congressman David Trone from Maryland's 6th District. I'm glad to join you for POMED's event, taking a critical look at Mohammed bin Salman's leadership. Tomorrow, October 2nd, marks 2 years since the murder of Jamal Khashoggi by agents of the Saudi government. The U.S. intelligence community has concluded that MBS ordered Mr. Khashoggi's killing. Although 8 defendants recently received jail sentences for the murder, the UN's Special Rapporteur on Extrajudicial Killings has called the trial mockery of justice. There has been no accountability for MBS or any other senior Saudi official, meaning quite simply, they've gotten away with murder. It's a serious problem for Saudi Arabia, the United States, and the rest of the world that MBS feels comfortable violating fundamental human rights and has learned he can do it with impunity. This man will probably rule Saudi Arabia for half a century. He likes to project an image as a reformer, but he's already shown himself to be anything but. We need to recognize the threat MBS poses to democracy, to human rights, and the stability in the region. I'm working in Congress to ensure real accountability by imposing real consequences. Thank you for coming together to discuss these vital issues, and thank you for listening. Take care, be safe, and let's do what's right.
Friends, today we gather to commemorate the extraordinary life of Jamal Khashoggi, prominent journalist, a visionary reformer, a loving father, and my constituent. On this fateful day, 2 years ago, Jamal entered the Saudi consulate in Istanbul and never emerged. Since then, the world has been denied his voice and his vision for Saudi Arabia and an Arab world that respects human rights and rule of law, that embraces democratic norms and values, and that guarantees basic freedoms for all of its citizens. Jamal's brutal murder is a direct attack on core American democratic institution, the freedom of the press. When leaders fail to stand up for press freedom and the right to to dissent. They empower oppressive regimes to undermine the truth. When leaders refuse to protect press freedoms by turning a blind eye to violence against journalists, they are complicit. The Trump White House has opted to remain silent on his death. We will not. And I will not let his death be forgotten or conveniently swept under the rug by this administration. That's why I'm working to pass the Protection of Saudi Dissidents Act, which would hold Saudi Arabia accountable for Jamal Khashoggi's murder and mandate concrete actions on the part of the White House. To honor Jamal Khashoggi's life and his legacy is to commit ourselves to journalistic freedom, to a free press, and to the right for all citizens to express themselves politically, including dissent. It's a defense of the truth. Thank you.
It is appalling that the G20 is taking place in Saudi Arabia. We still have to hold MBS accountable for his crimes against humanity. He has not had any accountability for the brutal killing of the journalist Khashoggi. There has not been any repercussion, and he has not had to account for his war in Yemen, which has killed thousands of women, thousands of children, thousands of civilians. The war still needs to end. Until MBS is held accountable, until the war ends, the international community should not be elevating Saudi Arabia. It is a mistake to be having the G20 there. We need to make it clear that MBS must be held responsible for his war crimes.
Good morning. I'm Congressman Jim McGovern, co-chair of the Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission. 2 years after Jamal Khashoggi was brutally murdered and dismembered in a Saudi consulate in Turkey, true accountability remains out of reach and business has gone on as usual. It's stunning, really. Who in their right mind looks at what happened to Jamal and thinks, yeah, I'm okay cozying up to Mohammed bin Salman? Yet this coming November, Saudi Arabia, an absolute monarchy that silences every dissenting voice and has no form of meaningful democratic representation, is set to host the 2020 G20 summit. It is time to say, enough. No more business as usual with the Saudi government. And that means no G20 summit until they tell the truth about Jamal's murder, free the human rights and women's rights advocates they've thrown in prison, allow independent media and journalists to report freely, respect freedom of religion, belief, and conscience, end the war in Yemen. And that's just the start. We will not achieve a peaceful or secure world as long as we continue to treat human rights as chits to be negotiated away in pursuit of arms and business deals. It's time to change the incentives, and Saudi Arabia is the place to start. Thank you.
Thanks again to all of these members of the House and Senate for taking the time to contribute to our event today. We very much appreciate their remarks as well as their ongoing work in Congress on behalf of democratic values and human rights in Saudi Arabia and elsewhere. Congressman Connolly mentioned his bill to protect Saudi dissidents, which he's actually introducing today in the House Foreign Affairs Committee. And this is a bill that we think is important and positive first step toward having some meaningful and long overdue accountability for Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman and the Saudi regime. Next, we're going to present a short clip from the documentary film Kingdom of Silence, which will premiere tomorrow evening at 9 p.m. on Showtime. Kingdom of Silence is a powerful film that examines the story of Jamal Khashoggi and his life up until he was killed 2 years ago. And through the lens of Jamal and his life, examines the Saudi regime, as well as the history of the U.S.-Saudi relationship, and frankly, the U.S. role in facilitating the abuses of the Saudi state, as we heard a bit during our first panel. After a short two-minute clip from the film, we'll have an interview with the film's director, Rick Rowley. That interview will be conducted by Sahar Aziz. Sahar is professor of law at Rutgers University Law School. She's also the founding director of the Rutgers Center for Security, Race, and Rights. And I'm proud to say that she's a member of POMED's board of directors. And with that, I present this two-minute preview clip from Kingdom of Silence.
fall of 2017, Jamal was in self-imposed exile. We met, and he gave me the biggest bear hug. It was really, really warm, and then he started crying. He said, I left my country, I left my family behind for freedom, just to be free. And no one knows what that feels like more than you. I learned later that his first Washington Post article was published that hour.
Saudi Arabia wasn't always this repressive, by Jamal Khashoggi. We spent endless hours on the phone trying to understand the wave of arrests. Are we going to be the core of a Saudi diaspora? Al-Hayat canceled my column. The government banned me from Twitter. I spent 6 months silent, reflecting on the stark choices before me. Years ago, when several friends were arrested, I said nothing. I have made a different choice now. I have left my home, my family, and my job. And I am raising my voice.
My name is Sahar Aziz, and I am a professor of law and Chancellor Social Justice Scholar at Rutgers Law School. I'm also the director of the Center for Security, Race, and Rights. And I have the unique privilege and honor today to interview Rick Rowley about his phenomenal film documentary, The Kingdom of Silence, that he directed. It will be premiering on Friday, October 2nd on Showtime at 9 p.m. Eastern. And I was lucky enough to get a sneak preview. And all I can say is it is both excellent and chilling and well worth the watch. So Rick, thank you so much for being with us today. When I watched the documentary and I thought about your previous projects, Dirty Wars and 16 Shots, what drew you to this particular project and what drew you to be interested in the story of Jamal Khashoggi?
I think the first thing is that Jamal was one of our own. You know, he was a reporter, a journalist who was murdered by the regime that he criticized. And whenever a colleague is killed, I think it falls on all of us to try to do what we can to rescue what we can of their story from the silence that their killers would impose. So that was the main thing. And the secondary part of it is that I'd spent around a decade covering wars in Iraq, Afghanistan, Somalia, Yemen, Lebanon, like the, you know, other front lines in the global war on terror. And in many of these conflicts, Saudi Arabia was an active participant, or Saudi money and Saudi fighters and Saudi backing was meddling in all of these different places. But, and every combatant on the ground would tell you that. But back in the US, in our media, it's very rarely discussed. It's sort of an unspoken kind of secret that this really toxic relationship between the US and Saudi Arabia has sown kind of chaos and violence around the region for a very long time. So those two stories were really important to me and were the things that brought me into this project.
And your documentary provides quite a bit of detail and history about that relationship between the United States and Saudi Arabia. What do you hope the impact of your documentary will be on American public opinion on the Middle East and on US foreign policy in the Middle East?
Yeah, I mean, Jamal's story is kind of amazing, right? I mean, it was sort of epic. I mean, he lived his life at the center of a whirlwind. I mean, he was not just a journalistic observer, but a participant, an active participant in all of these moments that, continue to mark our time. And so his story, his like arc through, these decades of chaos was a unique window into this relationship. And, I think it's beyond time. that the United States have the kind of open public debate about what we're doing in the region and what our relationship is to this like anti-democratic kingdom. I mean, I hope the first thing that I hope a new administration would do when they're looking at their foreign policy is to evaluate our role in the war in Yemen, for instance. I mean, the Saudi war in Yemen that we're active participants in is, the UN calls it the greatest humanitarian catastrophe on the planet right now. I mean, you know, who knows how many tens of thousands of children are dying from starvation and from American bombs right now. I mean, that is near the end of his life, Jamal, you know, after spending most of his life serving, you know, the princes of the Saudi royal family, turned against them around issues like this. And I mean, I hope that that can be reexamined. I mean, we also, you know, still hope for justice for Jamal. I mean, what that looks like is a difficult thing to imagine. It's hard in this current political reality to imagine the actual authors of this like grisly, horrific murder ever actually, you know, standing in the docket. But there are other things we can do. I mean, we can guard his story against the people who, you know, tried to silence him with his death. And we can keep it loud and keep it centered in the debate and not let him just be erased by this regime.
And based on the research that you conducted throughout the process, what do you see the U.S.'s role is in terms of obtaining justice for Jamal Khashoggi? Or, you know, were there points where you, in while you were filming this, where you realized the U.S. was an impediment or neutral, or you know, where does the U.S. stand, particularly in terms of justice for his brutal murder, which is factually a slaughter, right? It is the most horrific crime one can imagine. And so where do you see the U.S. in terms of your interest in seeking justice for Jamal?
I mean, well, there are two aspects to that question. I mean, one is, one thing that is many of the people we spoke to for the film, including, you know, former insiders in the U.S. national security establishment, like John Brennan and others, you know, point out is that this crime didn't occur in a vacuum. You know, it was a long period of impunity where this regime was allowed to do all sorts of outrageous things. I mean, Jamal Khashoggi isn't the first person murdered by Mohammed bin Salman or by this regime. What was shocking and what made it kind of punch through all of the noise was the fact that this was an American resident, U.S. resident, who was working for the Washington Post, a columnist for one of the most important papers in the world, who was murdered in this way. And so creating an atmosphere of impunity where the regime could do anything it wanted to and get the backing of the U.S. was certainly part of making this crime happen in the first place. And after it was committed, Trump stands alone in the global community as a voice who defended, protected, you know, tried to cast doubt on what was what every intelligence agency in the world, you know, said was a crime, you know, ordered by Mohammed bin Salman, and he continues to, in the most craven and callous way, cling to this regime who is, you know, guilty of war crimes, guilty of this horrific murder. I mean, the U.S. is absolutely essential to Saudi impunity.
Yes, it is certainly something that those of us who care about the international reputation of the United States are very concerned about. And it will be interesting to see if we get a new administration, how that will change. Now, stepping back a bit to before you started the filming and the interviewing and the kind of full project, what were some of the preconceived notions or ideas that you had that you assumed maybe would be proven true or would be proven false? You know, how did this experience produce any paradigm shifts for you?
Yeah, I mean, there are so many things that were revelatory to me over the course of this process. I mean, the biggest one were revelations about Jamal himself. You know, I mean, I at the very beginning of this process, I went in thinking, as you would if you read what could be read of him in English at the time, that Jamal was the eternal dissident, that he had been a critic of the regime, probably testing the edges of what was possible his whole life, and finally it caught up with him and he was killed for it. His real story was far more fascinating. This is a man who was lived at the center of power and in traveled in the most powerful circles in Washington, Riyadh, and London, who then finally the tortured contradictions of that became so great that he split from the regime, he became a critic, an exilee, and eventually a martyr. And that kind of turn was incredible and was a revelation to me. I mean, more generally, Afghanistan was, so I've been around nine or 10 times I've gone to Afghanistan filming different things. So I've been around the country before and I've covered, it's sort of interesting. Jamal was 27 when he went to Afghanistan the first time and started covering the war there. I was in my early 30s when I first went to Afghanistan and was covering in many ways the same conflict that he was covering, all these years earlier. So I was familiar with many kind of aspects of the war and certainly knew the stories of the Mujahideen, but the Arab Mujahideen who had come to join the fight against the Soviets. But to travel, to retrace his footsteps with Abdullah Anas, who was his, comrade at arms and friend for his whole life, was really gave a fascinating new kind of human character to that experience, because it's easy to think of those fighters as either, useful stooges of American foreign policy who have no agency of their own, but are just like, are pawns being moved around by, from Washington or Riyadh or Pakistan or wherever, or to think of them as insane zealots who are pursuing, their own kind of project. But the youthful hope that they had at that moment in history, the way people described that time as a moment when, after centuries of colonial twilight, like we as a region are reemerging and taking control of our own history into our own hands again for the first time, fighting a superpower and winning, like that, that was really sort of fascinating. And those, when Jamal then feels echoes of that during the Arab Spring, like echoes that are closer to the ground and clearer. It added a kind of a human dimensionality to this history that I knew but hadn't walked in before.
Your response is indicative of just how expansive your project was. I remember when I was watching it, I the documentary, I thought, wow, this really provides historical context, and it shows that, as you were discussing, in the 1980s, we thought the Mujahideen were freedom fighters, and then after 9/11, we thought they were terrorists. And clearly, this is something that journalists have a deep appreciation for. So as the film, as we prepare for the official release of the film on October 2nd, the 2-year anniversary of Jamal Khashoggi's death, and more accurately, his murder, about a month after a Saudi court announced sentences for 8 people charged in killing, when trials widely criticized for a complete lack of transparency and for failing to include any senior officials believed to have ordered the killing. This also comes just after Saudi Arabia is slated to host the G20 summit. So how is this film important at this particular moment?
I mean, yeah, I think you put it all out there. I mean, there's every, Saudi Arabia is putting all of their tools, are being deployed to try to turn the page on the story of Jamal Khashoggi and renormal and pretend that it never happened and normalize their relationships with everyone now. And I think that we can't let that happen. Agnes Callamard, the UN Special Rapporteur, called the trials in Saudi Arabia a grotesque caricature of justice. Which they were. The main perpetrators weren't tried. We don't know. There was a total lack of transparency. It's not anything like justice. It's a gesture that's trying to conceal the fact that justice is being avoided. And it's really disheartening to see, some people now, after they scurried away from the kingdom for months after Jamal was murdered, come back and renew their arrangements there. I mean, I am hopeful though. I mean, there is more, it feels to me, and I don't know, you can maybe have a better sense of this than I do. It feels to me like there is more discussion in Washington now than I can ever remember about the need to recalibrate our relationship and to reassess where we stand in the region, in our alliance with Saudi Arabia, and where we will be moving forward. And I hope that this film can both keep the story of Jamal alive amidst all these attempts to turn the page on it, and also help enliven and empower that conversation of looking at re-examining one of the most important foreign policy relationships that the United States has.
Yes, I think the documentary is essential for what you're discussing. Is we have to talk about it, right? Well, we have to have information, and most importantly, as you know all too well, independent analysis of the Saudi-U.S. relationship is really important, as we see an increasing use of lobbying groups by different foreign organizations in D.C., including Saudi Arabia. So I'm very grateful that you have put in so much time and so much effort and so much thought into producing this much needed documentary about this really important issue. So thank you so much, Rick Rowley, for directing and producing the Kingdom of Silence, which will be coming out on October 2nd on Showtime at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Thank you so much, Rick.
Thank you, Sahar. Thank you.
So next we'll be turning to POMED Deputy Director for Research, Amy Hawthorne, who will lead our second panel, Inside the Kingdom, Examining Social, Economic, and Religious Reforms.
Hello and welcome, everyone. I'm Amy Hawthorne, Deputy Director for Research at POMED, and I'll be moderating the second panel of today's conference. In this panel, we'll be taking a look at Saudi Arabia's domestic landscape under Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. What are the most important reforms that MBS has made, and what has he not done, and why? What are the main risks for him ahead, including potential sources of opposition? How might we expect Mohammed bin Salman to rule as king based on what we've seen in these past 5 years? I'm delighted to have three stellar panelists to explore these questions. Ben Hubbard is the Beirut Bureau Chief for the New York Times. And over the past decade, he's done so much important reporting across the region and especially in the kingdom. His new book is MBS, The Rise to Power of Mohammed bin Salman. Thank you so much for being with us from Beirut, Ben.
Thank you.
Madawi Al-Rasheed is one of the most insightful scholars of Saudi Arabia, her home country. She is visiting professor at the London School of Economics and Politics. And her latest book, with the excellent title, I think, of The Sun King, Reform and Repression in Saudi Arabia, will be published in 2021. We're so glad that you can join us today, Madawi.
Thank you.
And last but not least, we have Karen Young. Karen is a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute in Washington and one of the best specialists on the political economy of the Middle East. Her writings on the Saudi economy are must-read sources to understand dynamics under Mohammed bin Salman. Thank you, Karen, for being with us.
Thank you for asking me.
And before we get started, let me just say a quick word about format. I'll start off by posing questions to each of our panelists. And after that, we'll open things up for some questions from you, our virtual audience. To submit a question at any time during the panel, you may use the Q&A button on Zoom at the bottom of your Zoom screen, or send an email to communications@pomed.org. And I apologize in advance if I don't have enough time to get to all of your questions. With that, let me turn first to you, Madawi. And I'd like to ask you, is Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman actually returning the kingdom to a moderate Islam, as he claims he is doing, and reducing the powers of the religious establishment, as many observers assert? What is the actual nature of Mohammed bin Salman's relations with the religious establishment?
Yes, thank you for having me. There is a lot written and discussed about the religious establishment. And here we're talking about the Wahhabi movement that became the religion of the state. And yes, Mohammed bin Salman announced in an interview with the Western press, I remember it was The Guardian at the time, that he is going to return Saudi Arabia to moderate Islam. Now, everybody cheered and thought this is really what we need, and it's part of the propaganda machine of Mohammed bin Salman. But what we call the religious establishment had been very, very important in Saudi Arabia. However, it had a troubled relationship with the regime. And here, if you imagine two totalitarian systems, one the Wahhabi movement and the other one the House of Saud and the way it rules the country, they're bound to collide and they're bound to cooperate at certain times. But let me give you an example. The Wahhabi tradition and the religious establishment provides the Saudi regime and did provide the Saudi regime with great service. It fights its battles, it controls society, it prohibits civil unrest or civil disobedience, peaceful protest, and it provides the religious language by which Mohammed bin Salman now and previous Saudi kings used in order to depoliticize the population and even torture the population in the name of God. So this cooperation had been going on. However, as two totalitarian systems, one religious, one political, are competing over society and how to control society or control each other, they're bound to collide with each other. And this collision had been endemic to the relationship between the religious establishment and the Saudi state. And it started early in the 20th century, 1927, the first sort of battle between the two. And it continued with, for example, Juhayman al-Utaybi and the seizure of the Mecca Mosque in 1979 and the rise of jihadi movements in Saudi Arabia and globally, and even the Islamic States from 2014. And how did they collide? They collide because they are both totalitarian. They do not allow any kind of dissenting voices. There is no open debate. There is no criticism or discussion of any issue. And they both work top down and expect the population to obey, unquestioning any kind of order from above. So the religious establishment serves the interests of the Saudi state, but even Mohammed bin Salman cannot sort of let go of the religious establishment and abolish it. And why doesn't he do that? Because it still serves his domestic policy. So if, for example, he wants to make the population scared of, for example, any kind of protest, even if it is peaceful, he could unleash the religious establishment in order to tell the population that what you're doing is against the law of God. The second thing, so in terms of domestic policy, the religious establishment is extremely important. Also, in the war on Yemen since 2015, and even after Mohammed bin Salman wanted to introduce moderate Islam, we see Saudi religious scholars who are allies of the government taken to the battleground in the southern border of Saudi Arabia. For example, Mohammed al-Arafi, just one of them, with the military standing on military vehicles and telling the Saudi soldiers that they are fighting a jihad against the Yemeni Zaydis, who happen to be a branch of Shia Islam. So the sectarian discourse of the Wahhabi tradition is extremely important for the regime in order to sell the war in Yemen as a jihad against infidels who happen to be other Muslims, but they don't share the same principles and practices of the Wahhabi tradition. Again, in the war, in the conflict with Iran, the Wahhabi tradition renders great service to Mohammed bin Salman because it can unleash its sectarian rhetoric against the Shia, who had been described occasionally and most of the time, especially when there is a rising tension with Iran, as a fifth column, that people who can't be trusted, they're not even considered as true Muslims. So this is the domestic interest that keeps Mohammed bin Salman and King Salman in close cooperation with the religious establishment. And finally, let's not forget that the Wahhabi establishment and all the narratives, the discourse, the tradition itself served Western interests from the sort of during the Cold War, when this kind of radical, literal Islam was seen as an antidote to a nationalist and other liberation movements across the Muslim world and even among Muslim minorities in the West itself. So the United States, Britain, and other countries saw in the Wahhabi tradition as a good tool to be deployed in the Cold War against the Soviet Union and the leftist sort of movements that emerged across the Muslim world and beyond. And therefore, this is what makes the religious establishment just simply wouldn't go away. It's all these four factors, but the relationship remains tense, and there's always gonna be cycles of violence. And let's remember that the Wahhabi tradition, when it's if you imagine a sort of a totalitarian, Stalinist type of a communist party, where even dissenting voices, whatever they, their dissent is minor, they're not tolerated. And therefore the Wahhabi tradition, with the pressure of the government, splinters into groups that gave rise to the jihad, global jihad in Afghanistan and other destination in the whole world. And also it gave rise to other sort of confrontation inside Saudi Arabia. Let's not forget between 2003 and 2008, the splinter group out of the Wahhabi tradition erupted and practiced violence, not only against Saudi citizens, but also against foreigners living in Saudi Arabia. And the same scenario happened again in after 2014 and the rise of the Islamic State. So to say that now Mohammed bin Salman is promoting moderate Islam is another sort of propaganda. And what is really, really interesting is that this moderate Islam, usually in any kind of religious reformist tendency, you would allow open debate, discussion between religious scholars in order to arrive at religious interpretations that actually suit the population at a particular historical moment. But neither Mohammed bin Salman nor the religious establishment are interested in any kind of open dialogue that will widen religious debate. And the problem is that these two systems continue to rule in Saudi Arabia. Yes, Mohammed bin Salman had taken away from the religious establishment its grip on the population. King Salman restricted the Committee for the Promotion of Virtue and Prohibition of Vice, which is the long name for the religious police. He allowed people to experience certain very limited personal liberties. And that was extremely important for the religious establishments because they lost their control over that area. But the religious establishment really now has become redundant in Saudi Arabia, although Mohammed bin Salman can't completely abolish it because, as I said, he needs it for domestic and also regional policies.
Thank you very much, Dr. Madawi. I think the way that you framed the concept of two totalitarian systems was really, really useful in our understanding kind of this complex situation. Thank you so much. Karen, I'd like to go to you next and ask about the economy, obviously a critical issue in Saudi Arabia. And in your writings about Saudi Arabia, you've referred to a looming economic crisis. Can you describe this crisis and tell us how close you think it is to occurring?
Well, thank you, Amy, and it's good to be with you all this morning. Maybe looming isn't even the best word. Looming implies something that's sneaking up on you. And this is a seismic shift in what everyone has expected of a post-oil era. It's not a surprise. It's part of government policy to plan for it. That's what Vision 2030 is all about. But there is what I call a fiscal cliff. There is a point at which the trajectory of government revenues do not match government spending. And this has been exacerbated in the last 5 years, really since late 2014, and the trajectory of where global energy markets and oil markets are going. And so it's completely foreseeable. Governments know it and understand it very well. The problem is getting politics and society to understand it and to prepare for it. And so the necessity is that once you have more people competing for fewer resources, that generates new politics. And so that's the necessary outcome. It's true across the GCC, if we look at spending trajectories and revenue since late 2014, and there's an annual gap across the GCC of about $200 billion of the last 5 years each year. And so the outlook going forward in the period we're in right now is also a shock, right? We're in a twin crisis of the COVID-19 pandemic and of global oil price collapse. That's not necessarily going to get better quickly. And it comes at a very difficult time, of course, for Saudi Arabia and the diversification plans, because most of the sectors which had been targeted for job creation and economic diversification are the ones most sensitive to the impact of the pandemic. The other thing that's been happening over the last 5 years is a real drawdown in terms of the state's resources. So in the state's foreign currency reserves, in the central bank, as well as government deposits in the central bank, between 2014 and 2020, we've seen a decline of about 40% of those assets. Now, there's been a lot of kind of shifting around, one hand of government paying to the other and trying to finance and capitalize, particularly the sovereign wealth fund. But that nest egg that was created in the period that I call the magic decade between 2003 and late 2014 is not likely to be repeated. And that's because we're looking forward into a plateau of global oil demand. And this is a good thing because we're getting energy from other sources. It's not that global energy is declining or demand is declining, but the demand for the particular product that Saudi Arabia produces. And the government, and not just the Saudi government, but other oil producers in the region, have, as part of their economic diversification plan, an idea to be full-scale energy producers. And that's why they're interested in investing in renewable energy, in owning refineries and petrochemical facilities all over the world. They know this is coming. So it's looming, but it's no surprise, right? But even with those best intentions and efforts to cut the budget and cut fiscal spending, which the Ministry of Finance in Saudi Arabia is doing and making some very, I think, difficult but correct decisions right now, it's simply not enough to meet that gap. And that is that fiscal cliff. And so the politics necessarily have to change. And what does that mean for Saudi Arabia? It means in the next two decades, we're going to see pension systems which are underfunded. What we think of and has been calling the youth bulge for so long now, well, people aren't that young anymore, right? And as this group in their 30s and approaching their 40s gets to their 50s and looking towards retirement, there's not a younger, equally sized generation to replace them and help fund social services, pension systems, in order to take care of them. So that's a real kind of change in lifestyle expectations, in the social contract of what you expect the state to do for you. So even if you increase taxation, even if you have personal income tax, the value added tax has now been tripled to 15%, the state will be underfunded. And so that pressure to cut spending and to do more with less resources generates a whole new kind of politics, which I think Mohammed bin Salman understands, but yet at the same time has not been equipped to do much about. And I know you want to talk about that in another session, but I'll just mention, you know, why this future fiscal cliff gets so hard to deal with is because if you have competing priorities, particularly for social spending, public sector wages, it's also competing now with a debt repayment cycle. And this is true across the GCC. But what we've seen in the last 5 years, it used to be that the Gulf states were not particularly important in terms of emerging market debt issuance, but now they are leading it. And so the Saudi government external debt burden, what they owe in terms of their bonds, in terms of their commercial loans that the government borrows. In 2014, this was about $26 billion. In the summer of 2020, it was $213 billion and expected to increase maybe by another $40 billion just this year. So that's more than a tenfold increase in the last 5.5 years. And if you continue that pattern, you cannot make the same choices in terms of how you provide for your domestic citizen population.
Thank you so much, Karen. And building on that, could you just sort of briefly give us your sense of to what degree Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman's actions have brought this crisis that you've described so well closer or pushed it off? And if you could also tell us, what is the most important thing that needs to be done on the economic front? If you had to pick one thing that Mohammed bin Salman and of course, King Salman, the Saudi leadership should be doing in the immediate future, what is the most important thing that needs to be done on the economic front? And will the leadership, will MBS actually take that step?
Well, I think, you know, we have to be fair and give credit where credit is due. And I do think that the Ministry of Finance is making the right choices in terms of some very difficult cuts across budgets, cuts across benefits to vulnerable citizens in the Citizens Account Program, which is like a social welfare benefits program. But the key issue for Saudi Arabia, and not everything is Mohammed bin Salman's fault, has been a lack of foreign direct investment into the kingdom. And the decline in FDI predates Mohammed bin Salman's rise to power. But it is a trend that has continued. So, you know, we had FDI is about 12% right now of what it was in 2008. So there was a kind of a low period in the beginning of the 2000s that quickly rose to about $40 billion a year in foreign direct investment by 2008. And then it's been on a declining curve since then. And the actions of Mohammed bin Salman have not made that easier or better to attract FDI. And, you know, we certainly saw in 2017 in the corruption crackdown in the Ritz-Carlton, and then of course 2018 in the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, these problems got worse. There was a slight uptick in 2018, 2019, but we are still, you know, a tenth of where we were in terms of FDI 10, 12 years ago. And that rebound is very, very difficult. And again, in all the sectors where you hope things will do better, tourism, entertainment, hospitality are really dependent on external finance. COVID makes everything worse. That's not Mohammed bin Salman's fault, but it certainly is you know, a value prospect, which I think investors struggle with. The other issue is that his choices of where to make new projects, what people call the mega projects, NEOM and tourism development along the Red Sea coast are problematic as well, because they don't do a lot for domestic job creation. They aren't necessarily in places where people live. And so it reinforces this skills mismatch of how you want to move people outside of public sector work, but you're not necessarily able to create opportunities for them where they live and where they want to live and work. And then there's the issue of forced displacement, frankly, of people who are in these communities. So it's been problematic. The road ahead, it's certainly for the next 2 years, continues to be a very tough outlook as the global economy recovers from COVID. But the, you know, the longer term outlook for oil, for tourism, for conferencing in the region, all of these things are tough and require an outstretched hand and trust. And that has been, I think, really the weakness of the current leadership.
Thank you so much, Karen. That's a grim economic picture indeed in many ways. Ben, I'd like to turn next to you and I'd like to ask you about the challenges of understanding public opinion in such an opaque and repressive country. What does it mean for Mohammed bin Salman if at a time of such economic and social change in the kingdom, there are so few channels for citizen input on public policy, or maybe no channels? I'd like to hear your thoughts on that, if there are any channels. And Saudis are increasingly afraid to express their opinions about their government's performance, even in private.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely agree that it's very difficult to get a sense of sort of how Saudis feel about things, how the Saudis, you know, think about things, how they're reacting to policies that are going on. It's always been this way to a certain extent, but I think that the margins for any kind of expression, certainly about public policy, have narrowed substantially during the rise of Mohammed bin Salman. I mean, originally, you know, Saudi Arabia is a country with really no effective civil society, no public polling, no, you know, talk shows are all quite managed so that they sort of stay within the lines that the government wants them to stay in. So historically, they didn't have much of that. And it's definitely gotten, you know, the margins for expression have gotten much, much narrower under MBS for a number of reasons. I mean, some of this has been just outright political repression, arresting people, throwing them in prison, prosecuting them for saying things that the government doesn't like or publicly questioning government policies. There's a whole issue of sort of social media manipulation. There was a period when Twitter started taking off, you know, where many publications, including my own, did stories about how Twitter was going to be sort of this new parliament for Saudi Arabia. And I think there was an element of that that was true for a while. I don't think it's true anymore because, you know, I mean, when I look at Saudi Twitter now, it's just tons and tons of accounts with fake photos, fake names. It's hard to tell who's who. It's hard to tell who's a bot and who is sort of a government plant trying to do various things. And so, you know, there's no way to sort of get a systematic sense of what people are thinking. You know, the Royal Court has made efforts to try to gauge public opinion. These are all done privately. They're private, you know, it's been reported, I think, by us and by some of the other outlets have come across various times when they brought in either foreign consultants or other organizations to try to get a sense. I have no idea what kind of quality they're getting from that. You know, these things are never released publicly. I mean, in terms of the danger here for MBS, I mean, I think, since we're coming up on the second anniversary of, you know, Jamal Khashoggi's killing, this was never, as far as I'm aware, published in English. But before Jamal, one of the last big kind of writing projects that he did in Saudi Arabia before he left and moved to the US was something called the Saudi Vision 2030. So it was the Saudi Citizens Vision 2030. And it was basically his response to the Vision 2030 that MBS had responded. And it was basically that, you know, from the Royal Court, this is what Mohammed bin Salman thinks needs to happen. And me as Jamal Khashoggi, I'm going to tell you, as I think at that point, he was in his late 50s, saying, as a Saudi citizen, here's what I want to see. And one of the main things that he talked about, a lot of them are sort of charming in their simplicity. He wanted more parks. He wanted better zoning in the cities. He wanted sidewalks. He wanted, you know, more trees, things. I mean, it's like, we're not talking about trying to, you know, overthrow the monarchy. But the only political things he talked about in that series of articles were freedom of expression and free access to information. And he didn't argue for these because he wanted to overthrow the monarchy or because even sort of, but because he believed that they would bring about better governance, that, you know, government bodies will be better able to respond if they're being held accountable when corruption happens. And if they know what people think, if they know that people care much more about this issue than that issue. So anyway, that I think is an interesting perspective because I think it really raises a question of, you know, when you talk to people who have worked with MBS or who have done projects with him, he's somebody with a tremendous amount of self-confidence. He believes that he's right. He believes that he knows exactly where Saudi Arabia needs to go. You know, he'll entertain ideas, especially from foreigners, much more so than Saudis. He likes to bat around ideas and talk about big ideas, but he's really somebody who believes that he has a vision for the country that he wants to pursue. But the problem is when you shut down all of the possible challenges to that, or what are you going to miss? What are you going to miss that's bubbling up in your society, places where people are unhappy? If everybody's too scared to say, we're really angry about sort of the lack of jobs or the number of our children who are graduating from universities and not able to find jobs, you know, things like that. If you've sort of, you know, structured your society and your rule in such a way that you never hear those voices, then, you know, you're going to miss something, and it's going to make it that much harder to sort of craft your policies to deal with that.
Thank you. That's makes a lot of sense to me, at least. I'd like to ask you next, Ben, based on your, you know, extensive reporting and close observation of Mohammed bin Salman over these recent years, what do you assess as his greatest missteps and vulnerabilities since he's kind of risen to this position of immense power? And do you sort of assess that he's been able to learn from mistakes and recalibrate? And what does this sort of tell us, in your view, about how he might rule as king if, as is widely expected, he ascends to the throne at some point?
Sorry about that. I think I froze during the question, but I heard enough of it. His greatest vulnerabilities.
How you think, based on what you've seen so far, what might we expect from him if and when he ascends to the throne?
I mean, I think it's very important to recognize how young he is. I mean, he's now 35 years old. When he appeared on the scene, he was 29. And that sort of, you know, it's possible that that, I think the first thing to recognize is that the stakes with the direction that he decides to go are incredibly large. I mean, if he lives to be, if he becomes king, which I think pretty much everybody expects that he will when his father passes away, and he lives to be as old as his father, he will be ruling Saudi Arabia until the 2060s. So, you know, the direction that he decides to take the kingdom could be a huge deal for the kingdom, for the rest of the Middle East, for the relationship with the United States and other Western countries. So I think that's something, you know, something to kind of keep in mind when you're looking at what he's doing. And I think in terms of his vulnerabilities, I mean, it sounds kind of strange to say, but there's almost something tragic about the way that these first 5 years have unrolled. Because, you know, it is true that so many of the things that he wanted to do are the things that people in the West and many people inside of Saudi Arabia had been asking for many decades, you know, allowing women the right to drive, loosening up some of the social codes, getting rid of the religious police, trying to put some of the, you know, really nasty sort of Wahhabi thinking kind of back in the box and get it under control. I mean, these are all things that everybody had wanted, or not everybody, but certainly the West, and I think many people inside Saudi Arabia had been wanting the leadership to take on for a long time, and he has done it. I mean, but I think that the sad part is that he sort of washed away a lot of the benefit that he could have got from that in terms of his international standing, and in terms of just kind of his credibility because of all the negative and sometimes outright crazy things that he's done along the way. You know, I mean, if you're, you know, sort of do these things, but then at the same time be, you know, trying to get people to, trying to manipulate social media, you know, all the arrest campaigns that we saw. I mean, would it really have been that much of a threat to allow somebody like Jamal Khashoggi to live in Washington to write articles, or to allow, you know, the women who had campaigned for the right to drive for many years before it was actually given to them, just kind of the ability to take a victory lap, whether it was on Twitter or whatever, and say like, thanks, you know, like we wanted this and we got it. Like, was that really that dangerous? Did you really have to throw them in prison and in some cases prosecute them? So I think that, you know, one of his big vulnerabilities is that he has, you know, we've seen this pattern of very rash actions, things that don't appear to have a lot of thought behind them, I think, you know, and that they've done tremendous damage to his international standing. And I think, you know, getting back to the economic point that Karen talked about, I think they've actually been damaged to a lot of the economic work that he needs to do. Because if you're a foreign investor thinking about going into Saudi Arabia, you want to get involved in one of these new sectors, you know, and you think, okay, well, you know, this is a guy who can wake up one morning and throw like a few hundred people in the Ritz-Carlton on sort of unclear corruption charges and take their money away. Well, what happens if I'm an outside investor and I have a Saudi partner and I wake up one morning and this person has been arrested? Well, maybe I don't want to put my money on the line. You know, there's, and certainly because of the arrests and some of the more political repression, certainly the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, I think for outside investors, people thinking about doing business in Saudi Arabia, it's really added a new aspect to the calculation. I won't say it scared everybody away. You know, there's plenty of money to be made there in certain sectors. But I think for a lot of businesses, it's changed the way that they do that calculation, because it's very difficult now to feel that you are buying into this image of change and dynamism and, because it's very hard for people to ignore kind of the darker side of what's happened over the last 5 years.
Thank you so much, Ben. And thanks to all the panelists for your great comments. And now we're going to move to the Q&A portion of our panel, where we'll take some questions from our virtual audience. And just as a quick reminder, you can submit a question using the Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom screen, or you can send an email to communications@pomed.org. And the first question that we have is for Madawi. Madawi, the question is about this new political party that you and other Saudis in the diaspora have recently launched last week. NAS, I believe, is the name. Could you tell us a little bit about this party, what its aims are, and why you think it is, you know, such a significant step in sort of Saudi politics? That's the first question. Over to you, Madawi.
Yes, we did launch it on the 90th anniversary of the formation of the Saudi state, which is the National Day. And it's not the first political party ever. Saudi Arabia had known so many political parties in the 20th century, but of course they were all suppressed. Their founders were put in prison. And eventually with the 2015, the sort of political sphere became empty. There was a void. And not only when Mohammed bin Salman came to power 2017 and afterwards, but even before, following the Arab uprisings in 2011, when Saudi Arabia had known a wave of arrest of political activists, of people who had written petition asking for more rights, freedom of speech, and they came from different backgrounds ideologically and different regions, obviously, representing a cross-section of Saudi society. But in the last 5 years, there was this void, and the Saudi regime, also in some corridors of power in the West, they think that the House of Saud is sacrosanct, and it's so important for the stability of the country, for the flow of oil, for the arms industry. And nobody could imagine a Saudi Arabia without the House of Saud. And if you ask some diplomats in the West, they think, yes, they know exactly what they're getting into when they travel to Riyadh. They don't have a rosy picture of the Saudi regime, but they think if there is any instability, then the alternative is going to be Al-Qaeda or the likes of the Islamic State. And this has also served the regime, who frightens the Shia with the radical jihadis, who frightens the Sunni liberals with more restrictions if there is any instability. So the idea that we leave this void, given that so many Saudis are now in the diaspora in the US, we saw Hala earlier, and Yahya, Assiri, and there are people in Canada and in Australia. So, you know, my work is to capture these voices, and I thought there is a need. Those are like-minded people who believe in the principles and institutions of democracy. And as you probably know, over the last sort of century, two words had been taboo in Saudi Arabia: democracy, and it's always described as blasphemy from the West to corrupt our pious society. And the second word is political party, which is regarded as a schism, as a dissent, breaking the coherence and solidarity of the Muslim Ummah. So we were courageous enough, knowing that our families in Saudi Arabia and even us as individuals living in abroad in exile will be targeted. And we launched the National Assembly as a platform to capture these voices in exile. And the main principle is after 90 years, Saudi Arabia does not have a single institution that allows people to be represented. So we call for a national elected national assembly. We call for an elected government, respect of human rights, freedom of speech, freedom of assembly. And also we are a non-sectarian, non-regional political party. And therefore, this obviously frightened the regime. And since the 23rd of September, we've been bombarded by threats and even on using Twitter to say those people need to be beheaded because they violated these two taboos. You know, we uttered the word democracy and formed a political party. And therefore, we do not say that we are new. We built on the struggle of the Saudi people over the last half century, who had actually paid the high price. There were so many examples of people who lingered in prison and even died in prison for forming a political and civil rights association known as HASM. One of their founding members, Abdullah Al-Hamid, died in prison just 6 months ago after he was sentenced to something like 10 to 15 years in prison. He was like 75 years old. So we also captured the voices of women. And possibly, you know, we explain why the feminist movement had been targeted in Saudi Arabia. And for example, Lejina Al-Hidloul and her other members. It's because they were one of the unique voices that they imagined a national program rather than a sectarian or regional or Islamist program that by its own nature exclude others. So the feminist movement in Saudi Arabia was actually cutting across all the divides in Saudi society. And this is why they became defined as enemies of the state or national security threat, and even described as traitors and terrorists. So in the party, we have men and women, and some of us have different personal projects, personal lifestyles, but we came together simply because Repression has united this group of founders. And so far, over the last week, we've had so many people wanting to join, and we hope that we initially are going to work on directing our message to inside Saudi Arabia, where people can't actually say anything. And then the second thing is to work with the global community and international organization to raise awareness of the atrocities that had taken place under this leadership.
Thank you so much, Madawi. That's really, really interesting. The next question from our audience is for Karen. And the questioner asks, Karen, you described clearly the economic challenges that Saudi Arabia is facing today. And this questioner says, I know the country's budget generally lacks transparency, but do we have any sense of how much the country is spending on the war in Yemen and other military adventures, as well as other funds that it's sending abroad, such as foreign aid, and what effect this is having on the kingdom's economy?
Well, thanks, Amy. And it is sometimes difficult, especially to get a number on defense and military expenditure in the war in Yemen. I've seen estimates $1 to $7 billion per month. So choose your number. But it's a lot of money, and it certainly would make a big improvement and a difference in terms of the fiscal situation if that were to go away. And I think it is certainly a priority of the government to try and disengage from Yemen and make it less costly as quickly as possible. But at the same time, they are facing, you know, legitimate threats and missile attacks, and any government would want to spend on defense in that situation. If I could also kind of respond to some of the things that Ben mentioned in terms of the FDI picture, and also in response to Madawi's comments, it's, that's a problem, absolutely. But larger is this question of generating a domestic investment from domestic sources and people who feel confident and safe in doing so because of the political pressure. And, you know, what Madawi's political party is I think, emblematic of is what we will see is an increase in all kinds of opposition politics. And hers is from outside, and it's very much based on an ideological and rights issue. But we should expect opposition politics from people with vested interest inside the kingdom, particularly economic interest. And so when you talk about the ability to invest in the tourism projects, or the, you know, the mega projects, you know, the state is already trying to take a very, I think, heavy hand and leaning on potential sources of finance inside the kingdom. So there's a, for example, there's a $4 billion tourism fund to help small and medium-sized businesses get into that sector. And recently it was announced that the government will partner with local banks to expand that tenfold to about $40 billion of potential financing. But that money comes from somewhere, and people are being encouraged, that's a gentle way to say it, to be part of that state initiative. And so when large corporates, family businesses, people with resources feel that they have little choices in where and how to put their money to work inside the kingdom, that will create a different kind of political response as well, which I think is really important to foresee, and for the government to try to welcome and accommodate in some way.
Thank you. I just have a comment, Amy, if I may.
Please.
Yes, Karen, you're absolutely right. And we had demands, you know, from people to look at this economic situation, especially you already mentioned the confiscation of land for new projects that are almost mythical, like Neom City. And one citizen who lives in that area was actually shot by security forces because he refused to leave. And he took arms to defend his house when they came and wanted to evict him to make space for this new project. And also businessmen who don't feel safe and secure. And in a way, whether we're talking about foreign investment or domestic investment, this absence of the rule of law is extremely important. And it is a deterrent. Nobody wants to go into Saudi Arabia and invest when they know that their partner or themselves as foreigners might be targeted. Although at the moment, Mohammed bin Salman facilitates, you know, the residency of foreigners who can bring money and who could invest in the country and also allow them to do businesses. And you can see how a national elite who had been cushioned in the past because of state monopolies are being eroded, and they see foreign investment as a threat. So in a way, Mohammed bin Salman can't win. He wants the foreigners to come and bring money, but he's gonna alienate the very foundation, the elite that had supported him and previous kings. It's a very, very difficult situation. And in a way, the political party is a way of dealing, anticipating the implosion of Saudi Arabia from within.
Thank you, Madawi. Next, I have a question for Ben. It's actually two questions from the audience that I want to combine into one. And it's about the social reforms that Mohammed bin Salman has implemented and that have been highly touted by many. Do you anticipate any other significant social reforms that he might make implement in the near future? Or is what we've seen kind of what Saudis are gonna get for the time being? And the second part of that question is, could you envision a backlash actually ever emerging to the social reforms that MBS has implemented so far? We've heard in a lot of reporting, including yours, that there's a sense that the reforms that he's implemented so far, the social reforms, are popular among many young Saudis, but we don't hear much about the other part of society that may oppose these reforms. So tell us sort of what reforms you might anticipate, if any, and if you could envision a backlash emerging at some point.
Well, I try to stay out of the fortune telling business because it's a bit hazardous for a news reporter. I think he already made a lot of the quick wins that were to be made in the first few years. I mean, women driving has been on the table I think that, you know, a lot of the other, you know, getting rid of the religious police, I think that, you know, those were sort of obvious things that he could do that would certainly appeal to, I would say, you know, probably a significant or a large portion of the population, certainly the younger population, things that would also be sort of welcomed by the West and kind of help him increase his you know, kind of the his standing in Western countries. I don't have any sense of what else might be up his sleeve. I mean, he has repeatedly surprised us with things that, you know, I mean, when the day that they sort of took the powers away from the religious police, I didn't really know whether to believe it or not, to be completely frank. I like messaged a bunch of friends in Saudi Arabia and said, well, what do you think? And they said, well, we don't know either. Like, it took a while to sort of realize that, like, okay, this does seem like it was, you know, like it was a legitimate thing. And so anyway, I don't really want to get into sort of fortune telling about what other things might be in the pipeline. I mean, backlash as well is very difficult to see. I mean, I agree. I mean, I think that, you know, Karen has identified what I think the looming issue is. I mean, my guess would be the of it is going to be economic. I mean, that's really where Saudis are going to get pinched in their daily lives is they're going to realize that younger people are not going to have the same lifestyle that their parents had. They're not going to be able to live in these, you know, large houses with domestic labor and have walls around them and all, you know, they're going to have to, you know, and have sort of cushy government jobs where they only work a few hours a day. That kind of lifestyle that I think a lot of Saudis are used to now is going to go away because they just can't afford it anymore. How that works out in terms of backlash and things like that, I don't know. I mean, you know, there are sort of various models you can look to in Saudi history. You know, you've got, you know, certainly parts of the religious community, you know, organizing in various ways. You have, you know, on the political level, you've had people come together and sort of put forward official petitions calling for more rights, things like that, that the government has pushed back on. You know, then you can also go back to 1979, where you had, you know, a group over the holy, and, you know, and so, you know, it's very hard to predict. I mean, I do think it's, you know, it doesn't take, you know, for something crazy to happen, it unfortunately doesn't take a huge number of people. But I don't know, we'll just kind of have to wait and see. But I really think that the way that people are going to get pinched in their daily lives is going to be the economic component. I think that that's really the conundrum that he has. I mean, given all of the challenges that Karen laid out very well, unless he can find a way to create jobs for all of these young people and to, you know, deal with some of the financial issues, the lifestyle is going to change quite dramatically for many people. And in a way that I don't think they're probably going to be very happy about.
Thanks, Ben. The next question, and this is a question for all of the panelists, if you could just briefly answer, it's a hard question to briefly answer, but we're in a brief panel this morning. So your sort of quick immediate thoughts on what do you think is the best case scenario for Saudi Arabia in 2030? And what is the worst case scenario for Saudi Arabia in 2030? Karen, why don't we start with you, if you could just sort of briefly respond, and then I'll turn to our other two panelists for their thoughts.
Sure. Well, I don't think these pressures, these economic pressures in particular, necessarily mean revolution or a change in government. They mean there are new politics. They mean that people have a more vested interest in decisions that the state makes with the shared resources they have, right? And so the best case scenario for 2030 is that people have more input in that process and that people are more informed about what their potential to, you know, start a business, grow it, to what they can rely on and depend on as a pension from the state, what they could expect in terms of welfare support, that those things are clearly laid out and people can make choices and plans accordingly and organize themselves and advocate for themselves. That's the best case scenario. And I think it is still entirely possible because we're going to see a population that is with more women working, more female breadwinners and leaders of households, people that are living more in urban environments. I mean, it lends itself to all kinds of new politics, and that's exciting. Worst case scenario, as Ben describes, I mean, a couple of idiots can make a big, big problem. Not all protest movements are full of idiots, right? There can be peaceful protest movements that are very successful as well. But there can be upheavals that spook the state, that make the state crack down more forcefully, or frankly, the psychology of leadership can become very paranoid and stymie any opening opportunity.
Thank you. Karen Madawi, a couple of sentences from you, maybe what you think is the best case scenario for Saudi in 2030 and the worst case scenario that you worry about.
Well, there's always the problem of the power struggle at the top. The Saudi ruling house had always worked together with consensus, and they divided the states, the state institutions amongst themselves. So there was the Ministry of Information, the Ministry of Interior, Ministry of Defense, Foreign Office, etc. And it was that consensus that King Salman and Mohammed bin Salman has shattered with the Ritz-Carlton, and it's ongoing. So I think over the coming decade, he will not be able to rule without being haunted by fear, gripped by fear, lest one of those marginalized, disgruntled princes organizes something that troubles him. It doesn't have to be a coup. I don't think there is a chance of a coup, simply because he deprived them of any means of coercion or intelligence, and he's ruling on his own. But he is haunted by the prospect of some of those princes doing something that would undermine his rule. And they don't have to do anything big to destabilize the kingdom at the very top level. And I think the best scenario is for the Saudi leadership to realize the economic pressure, the fact that they are ruling without the consensus of their own brothers and uncles, and do something about it by enlisting society, creating the sort of, early shoots of a democratic system, and give power to the people. Maybe not give all the power to the people, because, we know dictatorships don't do that at a click of a finger, give some kind of engage the citizens in a kind of institution, not the sort of old-fashioned consultation when King Salman used to sit in his majlis, his council, and receive letters from citizens saying, oh, I need some help because my wife and I can't afford to hold a wedding for our son. It's not that kind of personalized politics that dominated Saudi politics over the last 50, 60, 70 years. That is over. It's a young population, a predominantly urban population, where face-to-face contact with the so-called patriarchs of the House of Saud is no longer possible. And Mohammed bin Salman, frankly, doesn't really engage in that politics anyway, the traditional type of politics. So Saudi Arabia needs to sort out its leadership issue, and it needs to engage its citizen in any kind of decision-making process to limit the damage that could happen in 10 years.
Thanks. And Ben, your thoughts for best case scenario and worst case scenario for 2030, where Saudi is in 2030?
Well, I think Karen and Madawi have laid it out very well. I think what's going to make the difference on whether it goes this direction or that way? I mean, I think what's going to determine which way it goes is going to be a shift away from sort of short-term flashy rollouts that look really good and that sort of create the kind of buzz. And we've and switching to a much more, sort of kind of the grueling systematic work of doing different kinds of government reform and things that are going to pay longer term dividends, but are not quite as sexy in the moment. So, we've seen, things like the Ritz. Okay, I'm going to get rid of corruption. And so, we're going to throw a bunch of people in a hotel and we're going to like bring down the hammer and we're going to take a bunch of their money away. But to this day, we haven't, nobody knows whatever happened to that committee. I mean, they created an anti-corruption committee the day that they did it. But we've never had any corruption trials. We've never had, other than the Ritz, they've never come out with a new corruption law that defines, how contracts are assigned, how they determine competitiveness, how government tenders are handed out. So we had this big flashy thing to sort of scare everybody about the corruption issue, but little reason to see sort of systematic change in ensuring that these kind of things don't creep back into the system again. NEOM, I think, is another example. Like, sounds great to announce it's going to be this amazing thing. We're going to spend a bunch of money on it. We're going to have robots and we're going to have glow in the dark. But like, is that really what Saudi Arabia needs? I mean, how many jobs for young people is that really going to create? And who's going to want to live there? It's out in the middle of nowhere.
So, you know, and then, you know, you can talk about the Yemen war, you can talk about all these other things. But I think that for Saudi Arabia to be in a good position in 2030, there needs to be a shift away from these kinds of flashy projects towards, you know, much the things that are going to be a little bit harder to sell. They're going to be harder to sort of make headlines, but it's going to be things like reforming the education system. It's going to be things like reforming the judiciary and the legal system to make things a little bit clearer, certainly for foreigners coming in. And, you know, these are not the kind of things that are going to get people really excited, and they're not going to, you know, you're not going to have sort of Western journalists coming in to sort of try to cover these things in the same way. But I just think when you look at how much needs to change for Saudi Arabia to even get to the place where MBS himself says he wants it to go, you need a lot of kind of this bureaucratic spade work, I would say. And I just don't think that there, you know, there's been a lot of evidence that he has the patience for it because he sort of wants these quick wins.
Thank you. You know, I'm really struck in listening to you all, just sort of focusing my mind once again on the magnitude of the economic and social, particularly economic challenges that Saudi Arabia faces, not as Karen said, as a looming crisis, but now and only going to get harder. And I'm really left wondering, you know, can an increasingly autocratic system manage the kinds of pressures and disruptions and opposition that is going to be generated as the economic and social landscape continues to change significantly in Saudi Arabia. Of course, Mohammed bin Salman and those around him might say, well, China's done it. China has managed to become even more repressive and yet, you know, achieve this economic success. But I think that misses key factors of difference in Saudi Arabia, particularly the reliance on the oil economy to date. And I personally don't see how the Saudi leadership and MBS in particular navigates all of these challenges without allowing more voice, more participation, more input in whatever form that takes to Saudi citizens, for them to be able to have some engagement and feedback to their leaders of one form or another peacefully about their experience as Saudi citizens and what their demands are going to be as citizens, perhaps paying more and more taxes. So with that, I'd like to close this second panel. Thank you all for participating so much today. Karen Young, Ben Hubbard, Madawi Al-Rasheed, we're really honored to have you. And there's so much, you've given us so much food for thought today. So thank you again so much. And now I'm going to turn things over to our third and final panel of the day on Mohammed bin Salman's foreign policy and Saudi's changing regional and global role that will be moderated by NPR's Jackie Northam. So Jackie, I'll hand things over to you. I'll sign off now. And thank you so much, everyone.
Great. Thank you very much, Amy. I think we're just getting some cameras lined up here and getting ready to go. Good. I think we're almost all on now. Just one moment. A couple of very interesting panels. Welcome to the third and final panel for today. I'd like to introduce some of my guests. We're still waiting for one to show up, but let me get started if I could. Yasmine Farouk is a visiting fellow in the Middle East program at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, and that's where she focuses on Saudi Arabia and regional foreign relations. Ms. Farouk studied political science at Cairo University and Sciences Po Paris. And prior to joining Carnegie, Yasmine was based in Egypt, where she taught political science and worked as a consultant for the Egyptian government and the United Nations Development Program. Welcome, Yasmine. Robert Jordan served as US ambassador to Saudi Arabia from 2001 to 2003, taking charge of the mission there shortly after the 9/11 terror attacks, a critical time in US-Saudi relations. And he wrote about it in his 2015 memoir, Desert Diplomat Inside Saudi Arabia Following 9/11. Ambassador Jordan is currently diplomat in residence and adjunct professor of political science in the John G. Tower Center for Political Studies at Southern Methodist University. Thanks for being here, Ambassador.
Thank you.
And Ali Soufan is chairman and CEO of the Soufan Group, an intelligence and security consultancy. He's a former FBI special agent who was involved in a number of high-profile anti-terrorism cases, and he's known for questioning the efficacy of using harsh interrogation tactics such as waterboarding. A new version of his 2011 book, The Black Banners, How Torture Derailed the War on Terror After 9/11, is now out, and it includes previously classified information, pardon me. So for more information on our three panelists, please see the event page on POMED's website. Yasmine, I'd like to get started with you if I could. I'd like to get a sense of how the Crown Prince is changing Saudi Arabia's approach to foreign policy in the MENA region. I mean, how would you describe his regional agenda or vision?
Thank you very much for having me today. And so I have to, just to make a quick remark about this in general, there is a lot of overestimation in the shifts that Mohammed bin Salman has done in Saudi Arabia's regional policy. You know, for people who know Saudi Arabia, have been following it closer. I think what happened with Mohammed bin Salman holds a continuation of the foreign policy orientation, but what he has really done is really make a paradigm shift in the sense that he made it, I would argue, extremely pragmatic. We have seen Saudi Arabia in the past willing to pay the cost, for example, of, you know, paying lip service or even paying the financial cost for preserving its own interest by not really adhering practically to normative frameworks such as, you know, pan-Islamic or Arab frameworks, for example. Mohammed bin Salman doesn't really care even about those normative frameworks. He is very, very pragmatic in his foreign policy, in the sense that when you follow his actions in the MENA region, there is always the question of, you know, what's in it for me? Like, what is Saudi Arabia is going to get out of it? Second of all, he's not afraid to be confrontational, publicly confrontational, including with allies. So we've seen the beginning of his reign in the region marked by confrontations even with traditional allies like Egypt or like Jordan, like most recently Pakistan, also Morocco. These were not directly public confrontations, but there were public tensions in the relationship or tensions that came out to the public. So I think the main difference that we have seen with Mohammed bin Salman is this excessive pragmatism, that this Saudi Arabia that is no longer cautious in, you know, expressing and acting to protect its own interests, no matter what consequences this is going to have on its allies or on the alliances it traditionally have. Something we also have to remember, whether with Mohammed bin Salman or before him, is that regime survival is always at the heart of his thinking about Saudi Arabia. And I think the thinking in Saudi Arabia has been marked a lot than what's written about by what's happened in 2011 in the region. How, you know, regime survival strategies and foreign policies should change to maintain regime survival. And I think part of his vision is actually thinking about, okay, how can Saudi Arabia better use its resources to be in a position to shape regional politics in a sense that would guarantee regime survival at the end of the day. And this is something that is very important, that also added to his pragmatism, made him think, okay, I need, you know, I need relations with Israel, for example, to complement, you know, the lacunas in Saudi Arabia's capacities or regional power. So I would, you know, to sum it up, I would talk about, you know, new pragmatism, outspoken pragmatism, more confrontational, and, you know, let's say an overstretching, if not overestimation, of Saudi Arabia's capacity to shape and reconfigure regional politics in a way that guarantees regime survival.
It's interesting. I mean, some of his foreign policy moves,
you know, have raised some eyebrows, have been questionable with thinking about the air campaign in Yemen, which has been devastating to that country, the blockade of Qatar, various others. I mean, how are some of these, I think what some people could consider missteps on his part, how are they being viewed inside the kingdom?
So, you know, this is a question always asked about Saudi Arabia and other countries, to be honest, in the region. It's, we have to be really careful when we are talking about how, you know, the, how the public opinion perceives Saudi politics or even more Saudi foreign policy for many reasons. One of which is especially, you know, in the recent years, there has been a doubling down on the monitoring, but also the shaping of the public opinion inside Saudi Arabia. And there has been, of course, a doubling down in repression. So you can imagine that within this context, even when polls are being conducted, they have their limits. But one thing I can say about, you know, we of course have indications and there are methodologies to work on, you know, assessing or having a sense of public opinions under authoritarian regimes. So one thing I would say is that you've had many reactions to those missteps. So pro-government people or pro-MBS people, the sector of the public who believes in MBS as the project of Saudi Arabia, have seen and those have dismissed those missteps with, you know, an ongoing ultra-nationalist discourse inside the country. That, you know, this the international criticism is unfair, and that, you know, he was preserving the country's interests, and that this is all part of a conspiracy not to have Saudi Arabia lead regional politics and lead its own foreign policy. Now, if you are on the opposing side of MBS, the narrative was more like, this finally shows that when you have the same decision makers taking you know, wrong decisions or harmful decisions inside the country, you cannot separate this from what he's doing outside the country. Eventually, it will rebound inside the country because it's simply the same person. But one thing that I see always, you know, overlooked in the analysis of how the Saudi public reacts to, you know, the foreign policy of the country is that because it drew so much criticism, because the missteps were so big, and because they drew so much criticism, there is a sense of, I would call it, you know, sadness or disappointment inside Saudi Arabia that, you know, every time they open a foreign newspaper, there's always something negative about their country. And there is hence some kind of feeling of resignation of, you know, we cannot do anything about this, but we're not happy that, you know, all everybody's seeing in our country is only the missteps of the crown prince. There is an entire country that exists beyond that. And I have to admit that, you know, especially when this criticism to his missteps is coming from the United States, the US since 2003 and the war in Iraq has lost a lot of credibility in the Arab public opinion in general, and in Saudi Arabia, since this is our subject today. And so this also was an element in defining how the public was reacting to his foreign policy missteps, because looking at, you know, how the rest of the world is reacting played a role in shaping the reactions inside the country.
Thank you very much for that. Ambassador, you were in Saudi Arabia, as we said, at a particularly tense time between the kingdom and the U.S. just after the 9/11 terror attacks. And somehow that relationship has endured, continues to endure. Can you explain what holds this relationship together and really why it's so important for the U.S. to maintain the relationship with the kingdom?
Sure. You know, Jackie, in prior days, commentators used to say the relationship was based on oil, God, and real estate. And oil certainly was a predominant factor. Maintaining credibility in the Muslim world was important. And Saudi Arabia's geographic location made it important to have flight clearances, because to project force in the region, you had to have the ability to overfly Saudi Arabia. Some of that, of course, has now ebbed and changed. Oil is less important to the United States, although certainly critically important to the rest of the world. And so maintaining supply channels, freedom of the seas in the Arabian Gulf, in the Red Sea, the Suez Canal are all very important elements of maintaining a relationship with Saudi Arabia. Economically, of course, they are a major purchaser of arms, but other elements of trade as well. Estimates of about $50 billion a year in trade over time. They have been, I think, particularly in recent years, a reliable partner in confronting terrorism. There have been a number of attacks that have been foiled by Saudi intelligence that has been provided. We've also, of course, had great cooperation from other Gulf and Arab countries. So I think that's been very important. We've also got, I think, a common interest in countering Iran. During my time in office, of course, the Saudis believed everything wrong with the world was the fault of Israel. They even accused Israel of launching the 9/11 attacks. But now in their narrative, everything wrong with the world is the fault of Iran and to some degree the Muslim Brotherhood. So we have a partner now who helps us balance our antagonism to Iran. Sometimes they are overreaching in that regard. I know former Secretary of Defense Bob Gates used to say that the Saudis want us to fight Iran down to the last American. And it now appears that both President Obama and now President Trump have wanted to back off from unsustainable commitments in the Middle East generally, and I think even to Saudi Arabia. So we've seen, for example, when Iran bombed the facilities of Aramco at Abqaiq in Quraish, the Americans did not respond at that time. The Saudis noticed that. And so I think what's happening now is they are becoming more responsible for their own neighborhood. This is something that even President Obama in his famous Atlantic article said was very important. So we're seeing now a rebalancing. There is still a degree of importance that Saudi Arabia holds for American interests. And I think if for some reason the regime were to fail and there were to be major instability in the country, we probably wouldn't like what we saw in the aftermath of that. So despite what I believe are egregious human rights violations, the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, who I knew and liked a lot, the Yemen war, and so many other human rights violations, there's still a lingering national interest that exists out there, but perhaps it needs to be better balanced with a recognition of some of the other missteps that MBS has made and a more resolute response to that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, President Trump and MBS have a relatively close relationship, in part, I think, due to Jared Kushner and the Crown Prince's relationship as well. I'm just wondering how this could change if Joe Biden becomes the next president. Do you foresee a profound change or a shift in how the U.S. might view Saudi?
I think there is likely to be some shift and a greater emphasis on human rights, on the rule of law, on developing more elements of civil society. Former Vice President Biden, I think, has said that he views Saudi Arabia as a pariah state. Those are strong words. My guess is there will be a somewhat more cooperative approach if he becomes president. But it will certainly not be the kind of personal relationship that President Trump and Jared Kushner appear to have with the leadership. Much of the relationships with Saudi Arabia over the years have been based at the leadership level. President Obama had a somewhat crusty relationship with the Saudis. President George W. Bush and his father, Bush 41, both had very close relationships with the Saudis. From a personal standpoint, I attended a couple of presidential summits with Bush 43, in which he and then Crown Prince Abdullah became actually very good friends, despite serious differences over Palestine and other issues. So it's in many ways, it's a personal relationship driven partnership. And I think the next president will continue to either have warm relations or frosty relations, depending on how the chemistry works.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Ollie, historically, one important component of Saudi Arabia's foreign role has been the promotion of ultra-conservative brand of Islam, Wahhabism, abroad. And in the previous panel, we touched on the issue of the Crown Prince's relations with the religious establishment at home. But to what extent is the Saudi promotion of ultra-conservative Islam abroad? How's that changing under MBS?
You know, thank you. It's still going on. You know, for decades and for various factors, Saudi Arabia was a primary and continue to be a primary exporter of radical Wahhabism. Matter of fact, Wahhabism serves as a theological foundation for the kingdom itself, which is built on a social contract, on an alliance per se, between the Wahhabi religious establishments and between the House of Saud. Also, this ultra-conservative religious brand serves as a theological foundation of Salafi jihadism, the violent ideological creed adhered to by organizations like ISIS, like Al-Qaeda, and so forth. And that is why probably we can explain that a significant portion of international terrorist attacks in the past decades have had some form of operational, logistical, financial, or ideological ties to the kingdom. And here I am not only including all the attacks targeting the U.S. or U.S. interests abroad, like, for example, the OPM sink in 1995 in Riyadh, or the East Africa Embassy bombings in August of 98, or the USS Cole in October of 2000, or even 9/11. But also more recent ones, for example, the 2019 Sri Lanka Easter attackers were connected to Saudi-funded institutions. And such institutions, such Saudi-funded institutions around the Muslim world continue, unfortunately, to produce radical narratives and graduate extremists and even potential terrorists. Matter of fact, in Saudi Arabia, entities in Saudi Arabia continue to support these radical madrasas. And we have seen them explode like we've never seen since aftermath of 9/11 2001. And I think the ambassador and the US government at the time worked with the Saudis in reining in these madrasas. But unfortunately, in the last few years, we've seen the number exploding. All the way from Africa to the sub-Indian continent to Southeast Asia, large part owing to substantial funding from various entities in Saudi Arabia and other countries. And that is extremely important because even if you look at ISIS, the group is so closely aligned with the ideology dominant in the Saudi official curriculum that the group actually adopted textbooks from the Ministry of Education in Saudi Arabia to instruct the children in ISIS-run schools. These textbooks arrive with anti-Semitism, with religious intolerance, sectarianism, and basically calls to violence. In 2018, MBS declared his intention to combat the cloud of religious extremists in the kingdom. But so far, instead, he has mainly targeting moderate or reformer scholars, human rights activists, and anyone who he perceived to be as a domestic rival. Meanwhile, radical clerics known to be close with MBS have still go on state television or on Saudi-funded satellite channels to declare sectarian narratives, promote religious intolerance, as long as it fits the Saudi regional agenda. I'll give you an example. There is a scholar in Saudi Arabia, very well respected inside the kingdom and in the Muslim world, Salman al-Auda. He has been always a problematic for the House of Saud. Salman al-Auda was probably the only scholar who stood up against Osama bin Laden, sent him a letter and held him responsible for every drop of blood he's spilling in his so-called jihad. Salman al-Auda today is in jail. However, the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia, who has issued fatwas calling for the destruction of all churches in the Arabian Peninsula, he said it's a duty of a Muslim if he sees a church in the Arabian Peninsula to burn it down. This person continue until today to be the Mufti of Saudi Arabia. MBS is even going after dissidents and critics overseas, including the United States, sometimes hitting, sending squads to intimidate or even eliminate any opponents, and sometimes armed with fatwas from some of these scholars in Saudi Arabia. These actions speaks that today, unfortunately, MBS's priorities are not related to eliminating extremist narratives, but to control and dominate the House of Saud and the kingdoms. Mm-hmm. If you look at our CT partners, people that we worked with after 9/11, and we had the majority of the relationship with them, and they have been amazing in helping the United States, as the ambassador mentioned earlier, disrupt the plots. These people have been purged by MBS, leaving the future of the relationship uncertain and vulnerable to the whim of literally one person. Examples of these people, Mohammed bin Naif, the former crown prince, who's now in custody somewhere, Mukrim bin Abdulaziz, some of the sons of King Abdullah, former King Abdullah, and so forth. So the reason that MBS hasn't been able to focus much or target the clout of these extremists, because supporting them and supporting the radical ideology is often viewed through the lens of the sectarian conflict, which is a way for Saudi Arabia to rationalize and frame its policies to its citizens and to even its allies. Saudi Arabia is one of the main drivers of sectarian narratives in the region. Iran is the other one. The kingdom adversarial relationship with Iran assessed as zero sum. Any Iranian gain is considered a Saudi loss and vice versa. And Iran is doing the same thing also, but they are using the Shia sectarian narrative, and they are using Shia groups in the region in order to do the same thing that Saudi Arabia is trying to do. Mm-hmm. So I think we are now in a position where we're seeing, even though MBS tried to, trumpet major progress in enacting long overdue reforms to mitigate the funding of extremist groups inside the kingdom. However, I think the government so far continued to narrowly focus on arresting domestic rivals, which is indicate that MBS is more devoting his attention and resources inside the kingdom to consolidate power than to curb extremists outside the kingdom. Even when, with countering finance and terrorism, for example, financing terrorism, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia undermined our United States CT interest by blocking efforts to impose multilateral sanctions under UN Security Council resolutions on ASIS affiliates in Saudi Arabia, in the Sinai, and in the Caucasus. Now, granted, they have their own reason to do so, but that shows you that, in a way, what Yasmine was talking about, what's in it for me? I don't care about your CT interest. I care about how I can, use all these things to my own interest.
Let me just ask you, given all that you said there, Saudi Arabia has been cast by many observers, it's been especially the US, as a bulwark in the region, sort of a counterbalance to Iran in that. Given everything that you've said now, especially about the extremism part, are there concerns that the crown prince could become a source of regional instability and extremism? Could he jeopardize, that perception that he has in the U.S. of being, again, this counterbalance for Iran?
Sure, there's significant concern about this, not only in the United States, but many allies in the region for Saudi Arabia and also in Europe and Canada. Look, since the 40s, the United States and Saudi Arabia operated within a strategic cooperation agreement. This relationship went through various challenges over the years, including the 9/11 attacks, and the ambassador had to manage the repercussion of these problems that happened after 9/11. Saudi Arabia, has a very important role and influence in the region and in the world due to economic reasons, religious reasons, geopolitical factors. And, remember, this Saudi Arabia manages the birthplace of Islam. Mecca and Medina, the two holiest places in Islam, are based in Saudi Arabia. So it has a special place in the hearts of Muslims around the world. It has a very large oil high oil reserve. And it has direct impact on, the oil market and the prices of the oil market. However, recently, as the ambassador mentioned, that the relationship with Saudi Arabia is less about oil and more about two main issues. Our concern vis-a-vis Iranians' hostilities and activities in the region, and our CT cooperation. And unfortunately, what we see today, that the policies of MBS have self-inflicted considerable damages and created challenges both at home and abroad for him and for Saudi Arabia. And this made many in Congress, it's actually one of the few things in Congress that today we have bipartisan support for, and many in the region and many allies around the world question the logic of any further strategic cooperation with the kingdom under the leadership of MBS. Why? For example, let's talk about the CT cooperation. And we mentioned a little bit about you know, his way in dealing with trying to curb Iran by using sectarianism. And today, sectarianism, unfortunately, came because of the activities of Iran and because of the activities of Saudi Arabia, the geopolitical currency to advance these two regional powers' political goals in the Middle East. The struggle for regional hegemony between Iran and Saudi Arabia benefited terrorist organizations and radical organizations, both on the Shia side and on the Sunni side, to exploit the sectarian hatred and leverage recruitment and justify violence. So basically, he's trying to use sectarianism to curb Iran's influence. That is basically leading Saudi Arabia to, wars in Yemen, that's providing, oxygen for terrorist organizations inside the country. And basically allowing Iran to become more powerful in the region rather than weaker. MBS would like us to believe that he is the best buffer against Iranian ambition in the Middle East. These narratives can be true if he is not acting recklessly. MBS's power consolidation domestically, his strategic blunders abroad, is actually weakening his position and weakening our position in the Middle East, both from a CT perspective and from a geopolitical perspective. We talked about how our reliable allies and the people who were the anchor of our strategic relationship, intelligence relationship in the kingdom, has been removed because of his anti-corruption campaign, which all of us know has nothing to do with corruption, but has everything to do with ruthlessly consolidate his power inside the kingdom. But also MBS already carried out a lot of miscalculated foreign policy decisions that is backfiring, disastrously at the kingdom. And as Yasmine mentioned earlier, it becomes difficult to differentiate between the domestic and the foreign. We can talk about the kidnapping of the Lebanese prime minister, bombing civilians in Yemen, sometimes using U.S. weapons to do so. By the way, dividing the GCC, as you mentioned, Jackie, with the Qatar fiasco, dismembering a Washington Post journalist, Jamal Khashoggi, all these acts are by extension weakening the United States position and weakening our own interest in the Middle East. We are signaling to the people of the Middle East that Osama bin Laden, that the Iranians, that Ayatollah Khomeini, that our adversaries were right all along. We're signaling to them that the US will prop up any authoritarian ruler as long as we can sell weapons to them and we can get cheap oil in return. In addition, MBS's action may also serve to empower Iran's proxies network in the region, as we've seen in Yemen. Look at the situation in Yemen. For example, you mentioned a little bit about the humanitarian crisis, but look at what's happening with the Salafi jihadi organizations and how they are thriving. Prior to the conflict that broke out, I believe in 2011, Al-Qaeda and the Arabian Peninsula, or lots of people in the media call them AQAP, they probably had about an estimate of 700 to 800 members. Today, the State Department assesses them to be in the thousands, maybe 8,000 to 9,000 people. Additionally, reports have detailed how the Saudi coalition have supplied US-made weapons and armored trucks to militias in Yemen that ultimately ended up in the hands of Al-Qaeda and Al-Qaeda affiliates organizations. So, you know, while the Saudi-led coalition wages endless war with mounting civilian casualties and humanitarian crisis that will probably last for generations, the jihadis are reaping the benefits. Mm-hmm. You know, the Saudi onslaught in Yemen has arguably only served to strengthen, as I mentioned earlier, the position of the Iranians and their proxies. Iran today has a foothold in the Southern Arabian Peninsula. Iran today have their sights on the strategic Bab al-Mandab Strait, very strategic for us and for the world, something that they did not have before MBS's Yemeni's adventure. Iran directly and through proxies in Iraq and in Yemen have the ability now to strike on Saudi energy infrastructure and cities as they did a few times already. And Iran successfully was able to replicate its Lebanese model in Lebanon on the borders of Saudi Arabia. They have Hezbollah to support its interests in Syria and in the Arab-Israeli conflict, and now they have al-Houthis to support their, you know, the Iranians' wider interest in the Arabian Peninsula. So needless to say, I share a lot of the concerns that an important ally is being weakened and a strategic partnership is being currently wrecked by the reckless policies of an inexperienced leader.
I just wonder if we could just switch gears a little bit here, and actually we should probably get to questions as well. I just want to introduce the issue of Israel. You know, we've seen a couple of Gulf states normalize relations. We've got a couple of questions from David Mack. What are the pros and cons for Saudi Arabia of normalizing relations with Israel? And what are the major constraints on MBS other than King Salman's public view? Yes, maybe we can start with you or Ambassador, whoever would like to pop in on this is great.
I can start if you want. So as I said, you know, before, the relationship with Israel falls within this new vision of what is actually dubbed inside Saudi Arabia, the new Saudi Arabia, but also the discourse of, you know, Saudi Arabia first. This pragmatism that a relationship with Israel serves on the bilateral level, but also serves in improving Saudi Arabia's image internationally, especially in the West. The emphasis on how the West sees Saudi Arabia is something that is very important to MBS and to the Saudi leadership today. And is a public relationship with Israel provides this kind of, you know, credibility that Saudi Arabia is changing, Saudi Arabia is more moderate. Most importantly, Saudi Arabia can use the defense and security cooperation with Israel. It is already using it, unfortunately, against dissidents where you have, you know, intelligence cooperation, but also buying Israeli software that was mentioned in the previous panel as well, but also in systems of defense inside Saudi Arabia. And so, again, this extreme pragmatism that, you know, whatever the Israelis can offer me in terms of, you know, opening doors in Washington that have been closed because of what has been seen as Saudi missteps in DC, all these are motivating, you know, especially the Crown Prince to go public with the relationship with Israel. But here's the thing, the tremendous American pressure that is put on by the Trump administration specifically on Saudi Arabia to go public with relations that are already being developed with Israel is actually, as Ali said, weakening Saudi Arabia itself. You know, if you think that it is important that Saudi Arabia, you know, normalizes. And again, I put this between quotations because I don't think that the relationship imposed from the top between Israel and Saudi Arabia is going to lead to normal relations or warm peace on the people-to-people level or people-to-government level. But anyways, if you think that it is important because of Saudi Arabia's status and because of what, you know, in Bob Woodward's last book, you know, President Trump says, you know, they are big. Saudi Arabia is big, and hence it is important in the Islamic world to see this big power. But actually, you'd be discrediting them. you'd be taking away this big, you know, in their power if you push them into a step, and if they push themselves into a step that will discredit them in the on the popular level, but also in the Islamic world, especially at a time where Saudi Arabia is facing challenges and contestation of this Islamic leadership from other countries. And because, again, of very pragmatic positions that I talked about, for example, when it comes to the Uyghurs in China, when it comes to what's happening in Kashmir, when it comes to the change in narrative inside the press, but also in government-controlled social media about Palestinians, about the Palestinian cause. So I think that it is not in Saudi Arabia's interest to actually right now, without a negotiated and just solution for the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, to open up to this normalization, despite the very pragmatic, if you want, interests in having a relationship with Israel. In terms of the opposition, where does the opposition come from? You know, I have said at the beginning of my first answer that we should always, you know, be cast some doubt on polling inside Saudi Arabia. Not that it's not accurate, and not that the methodologies are, you know, always lacking rigor. It is just because, again, of the authoritarian setting in which these polls are conducted. But even if you take those polls, none of the polls, including those that came out recently from, you know, James Zogby or from the Washington Institute, for example, here in Washington, D.C., say that there is a popular buy-in for the new narrative that the Crown Prince and his entourage are trying to market inside Saudi Arabia, that, you know, we should put Saudi Arabia first and we shouldn't care about the Palestinian cause. Even those who buy into the narrative that the Palestinian leadership is more responsible for the fate of the Palestinians today than Israel is, and even those who condemn Palestinian demonstrations where, you know, the Saudi flag or where pictures of the king and the crown prince were burned, even those, you know, understand that there's a difference between the Palestinian leadership and the Palestinian people, and that it is a matter of principles. It is not just a matter of who is representing the principle. So I think that, again, and from my own, you know, qualitative research, if you will, meaning interviews with people, monitoring closely Saudi social media, but monitoring the Saudi media and interacting with others, I can tell you that I have seen the buy-in into the new narrative, but I cannot talk about, you know, the popularity, even the hyper-nationalist discourse that says we should have a relationship with Israel, a public relationship, because it's in our interest and we should put Saudi Arabia first. Even this discourse is now being contested, because this discourse has transformed every critical Saudi into, you know, a traitor, someone who doesn't support the official narrative of the country. So to sum it up again, even if, you know, there are pragmatic interests that have to do with security and defense cooperation, that have to do with opening closed doors in Washington, D.C. and improving Saudi Arabia's image, this will really discredit Saudi Arabia and will take away for it what makes it special, what makes it a regional and even a global player on the international scene.
All right, thank you. Ambassador, did you have any thoughts on that as well? I mean, you were talking about U.S.-Saudi relations, and I'm just wondering, would this help cement those relations if, you know, if Saudi did, I'll use the quotation marks, like Yasmine, normalized relations? Oops, I think you're muted there, sir. There
you go. I think the Saudis joining in this effort would be well regarded by most of the United States. But I think we need to remember the role of King Salman here. I think it is, to a great degree, King Salman's influence that has kept MBS from jumping in, along with the UAE and Bahrain, in this effort. I met with King Salman when he was governor of Riyadh, right after I arrived in Riyadh in the wake of 9/11. And I asked him, how could it be that 15 of the 19 hijackers were Saudis? And he said, no, there were no Saudis in these attacks at all. This was an Israeli plot. The Israelis did this. And I think there is a narrative in the senior cadres of the royal family, if not much of the elderly population of Saudi Arabia, that Israel continues to be the evil empire, continues to subjugate the Palestinians. And this is something they care deeply about. even though there's a certain element of hypocrisy in the fact that we don't see any Palestinian resettlements in Saudi Arabia. We don't see much action on behalf of the Palestinians other than rhetoric in many cases, and to some degree money. So I think this narrative is still important to elements in Saudi Arabia that would make it difficult internally right now for the Saudis to join in normalization. I did meet with Crown Prince Abdullah in 2002 when he unveiled his normalization plan after having disclosed it to Tom Friedman of the New York Times. That was a more aggressive quid pro quo, of course, than what we're seeing now. We're getting a much more benign kind of offer from the Israelis, namely, not for the moment annexing Palestinian territories. So I think this is a constraint on MBS for the moment. When King Salman passes on or MBS ascends to the throne, we may see a different approach. Certainly Bahrain would not have joined this group had it not been with Saudi tacit approval, and perhaps also Sudan as well.
Yeah. It's interesting because throughout all the moves by the Crown Prince, again, questionable moves, I've always wondered where the restraining hand was from King Salman. It just, you know, he seemed to almost have carte blanche, the Crown Prince, but this was definitely the one where there was a breach.
And we also saw it in the aftermath of the move of the U.S. Embassy to Jerusalem, which was ignored pretty much by MBS, and then King Salman, after a period, came out vociferously against it.
Mm-hmm. But let me add something here, if you don't mind. I mean, I totally agree with the assessment of the ambassador, but also I totally agree with Yasmine and what she said about this issue. Look, we mentioned how Saudi Arabia is trying to counter Iran using Sunni extremism. Can you imagine to tell these Sunni extremists that now we're going to support Israel? Now we're going to normalize our relationship with Israel and betray the Palestinians. This is going to be significantly blow for them. That second, the only thing that Iran has in the Muslim world outside supporting Shia groups in Iraq and in Yemen and Lebanon and Syria, the only thing they have is the Arab-Israeli conflict. The Iranians, the last Friday of every Ramadan, they made it the day of Jerusalem. It's a moment, the heart of the Muslim world, the birthplace of Prophet Muhammad, the place that housed Mecca and Medina, normalize relationship with Saudi Arabia. I can guarantee you, Saudi Arabia will lose its leadership in the Muslim world, because the Muslim streets in Malaysia, the Muslim streets in Indonesia, the Muslim streets in Pakistan, in Iran, and don't forget Turkey and Erdogan with his neo-Ottoman ambition in the Middle East will jump into that opportunity. And Saudi Arabia, I think, might be the next Iran. After the Shah normalized relationship with Israel and created and paved the way, among many other different reasons, the pathway to the 1979 revolution and the Ayatollah Khomeini. Mm-hmm. So I think they have to be very careful about this. I think there's a great relationship going on under the table in that culture. You know, I look the other way. I know what you're doing, but you're not putting it in my face. That's fine. You put it in their face. And Saudi Arabia today, because of the actions of the Crown Prince also, there's problems with the Pakistanis, there's problems with the Malaysians, there are problems with the Iranians, there are problems with Erdogan in Turkey. So I think that's going to be a significant blow to the Saudi government if it happened. They need to be very careful about that. And we need not to push them to do something that will weaken them further and weaken us further in the region.
Interesting to see how it turns out, again, because the Crown Prince has made some questionable moves since he making his way up the ladder. I've got a question here from Shai. I hope I've got that right. Franklin, can you address the regional division of labor between MBS and MBZ, where Saudis take the lead in some theaters and UAE and others, including Yemen, Libya, and normalization with Israel? Who would like to address that?
Ambassador, if you want to go ahead, please.
After you.
Okay, I'll try to be brief. So I think that we have to be cautious as the years go by since Mohammed bin Salman became, you know, prominent in Saudi politics and until today. When we talk about the UAE and Saudi relationship as being a complete alliance or a complete alignment, yes, they are aligned with each other, but, you know, it is no longer clear that they are not also competing in some theaters and that in some files there hasn't been much coordination as we expected or as we thought there was before. For example, I am not sure that what's happening in Yemen today is a clear division of labor between Saudi Arabia and the UAE. I am not sure that the UAE, you know, the UAE officials themselves said that very clearly that their negotiations of their deal with Israel was done on a bilateral level, that no other party was involved. And, you know, all the news coming out of Riyadh is that there was a notification, but there wasn't necessarily, you know, a consultation, as used to be the tradition when dealing with such huge step in the region when it comes to Saudi Arabia, right? So yes, there is a continued alignment, and definitely the two regimes are very keen on making it look like that. But there is also competition, and there is also, you know, some kind of wariness, especially if you talk about, you know, the old elite or the old guard in Saudi Arabia when it comes to the UAE strategic expansion in the region. Because we have to give it to the Emiratis, they are way more strategic and efficient and effective than the Saudis are, especially as we go on. Saudi Arabia has put itself in a difficult situation. And as I said at the beginning of my talk, they have overstretched themselves, causing themselves too many problems inside and outside the country that they have to manage. And that actually, you know, prevented them from continuing these regional expansion or strategic plans that they had with the UAE since the beginning.
I would just add, and I think Yasmine has it exactly right, but I think the murder of Jamal Khashoggi has also been a stressful point in the UAE-Saudi relationship. My information is that the Emiratis were absolutely aghast at what happened, and clearly it has to have colored MBZ's relationship with MBS at least to some degree. So my guess is it's not quite as close as it was before, certainly not as consultative. And the Emiratis, just to put a further point on the Yemen conflict, the Emiratis are using that conflict in a way to develop naval bases and ports throughout the Gulf of Aden, into the Red Sea, and in many ways are finding ways to achieve both military and commercial opportunities as a consequence. And they've also, as Yasmine alluded to, been more interested in perhaps a separatist movement in southern Yemen than the Saudis have been. This, I think, is a major potential splitting point between those two countries.
Are they not pulling back on their military effort as well in Yemen? I mean,
they pulled back significantly. Basically, the military effort in Yemen. They were providing mercenary ground troops while the Saudis were providing the air attacks, and the ground game there has not gone any better than the air game. So they have definitely pulled back, and they've actually, some reports say, initiated discussions on resolving the conflict with Iran. Mm-hmm.
Just as a, unless Ellie, you have something, we've only got a couple more minutes, last five. And we've got a question here, you know, talking about boycotting the G20 coming up and that, but I'd like to frame it in such a way that, you know, some of these very controversial, very dangerous moves that the Crown Prince has made, and just the blowback internationally on it. So that's what I'm hoping to come into the question is by, the question is by Sanjeev Berry. How will the Saudi state experience and interpret the growing tide of boycotts regarding the Saudi G20? In the last 2 weeks, the mayors of Paris, London, New York City, and Los Angeles have all dropped out of the G20 mayor summit that is underway this week. And again, it's for part of a broader thing. I'm wondering if we will increasingly see this type of boycott, this pushback from the international community because of the plans, projects, whatever that the Crown Prince has implemented?
Look, imagine if Iran get a journalist in one of their embassies from the Washington Post and they dismembered him into pieces. Imagine if Iran is bombing the Yemeni people like we, that the Saudis, that the air campaign of Saudi Arabia is doing. I mean, Iran is our adversaries and we expect them to do evil things, but this is our ally and this is a G20 meeting. Do we, as the world, recognize the activities by the G20? But let's not be fooled. The G20 is an event that's gonna happen where it solidifies Mohammed bin Salman's position in the world. The last meeting that they had it, I think it was in Brazil, nobody would even shake his hand except Putin. So now, are we gonna talk about our values when we're competing with the Russians and the Chinese adversarial powers and authoritarian regimes that's trying to take advantage of COVID and all the things to say that democracies don't work, come to authoritarianism, and we go there and we bow to an authoritarian regime that's killing people, dismantling a journalist, putting a human rights activist, a woman rights activist in jail in Saudi Arabia? Or do we stand up for what we believe in? Do we stand up for what Ronald Reagan talks about, the shining city on the hill? And I salute the mayor of Paris and the mayor of New York, and even though I disagree with the mayor of New York almost on everything else, and and the mayor of London for taking the courageous step and standing up for what their people believe in.
But isn't it also interesting that we're only talking about mayors right now? We're not talking about prime ministers.
Exactly.
And we're not talking about the private sector and how they flocked back to the Foreign Investment Initiative last October on the one-year anniversary of Jamal's death. Jamie Dimon and others boycotted the first year, but we're not seeing that kind of boycott from the private sector either. Mm-hmm.
If I just have, I can add just for 1 minute, it's absolutely right. You know, there is a difficulty with all authoritarian regimes, especially in the Arab world, to make them understand the impact when the reaction comes from, as the ambassador and Ali said, on lower levels. It has to be, again, Saudi Arabia has been known under Mohammed bin Salman for big things like NEOM, huge concerts, you know, big foreign policy moves. I think it took him time and it took his entourage time to understand that even those small moves are important. And as long as there are not significant reactions from the top levels, I don't think, you know, the message will be completely received in Riyadh. Now, I am saying this while at the same time understanding that Saudi Arabia has leverage on all countries. What really makes Saudi Arabia different in the Arab world, but also in the Middle East, is that it is not only a regional player. It's a global player. We have seen when the United States, you know, fully adopted this narrative of, you know, we don't need Saudi oil, we don't need Saudi Arabia. And then Saudi Arabia decided to take a sovereign decision in its oil production. And you have seen, you know, the US suddenly realizing that, oh, we actually need to coordinate with them. And this makes the tasks of many countries difficult. Even, you know, even I think the ambassador talked about, you know, Saudi Arabia being a bipartisan issue in the Congress today. However, you will hear a different narrative from the senators and congressmen and women representing states where you have a very thriving defense industry, thanks to Saudi Arabia, than the one you're going to hear from those who don't benefit directly from this industry. So we have, you know, there is this leverage that Saudi Arabia has and is playing.
Good, lovely. Listen, I'm sorry, we're going to have to call it quits there. It's been great. Yasmine, Farouk, Ambassador Robert Jordan, and Ali Soufan, thank you very, very much. I'm going to hand the screen back to POMED's Executive Director, Stephen McInerney. And Stephen, take it away. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Really appreciate you doing a great job of leading that fascinating discussion, which is our concluding panel to today's event. Before closing this event, I'd just like to offer a few brief concluding thoughts and words about some next steps as well. We had a number of key goals for today's conference. First, to illuminate various aspects of the situation inside Saudi Arabia to help shed light on an enormously important yet maddeningly opaque country. In addition, we sought to examine the various ways in which Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman is changing the kingdom and also the ways in which he's changing the role of Saudi Arabia outside its borders. We do realize that these are some pretty large questions, too large perhaps to cover exhaustively in the time we had available today, I think our speakers have given some great insights while also raising some questions for further exploration. One theme that came up a lot throughout today's conference, and most clearly perhaps during the last panel, is the nature of the U.S.-Saudi relationship, which, and what U.S. policy towards Saudi Arabia is and should be. These are questions that POMED has really been at the heart of POMED's work and mission since we were established. While we heard some great insights into some of the current challenges to U.S.-Saudi relations, many questions remain about what U.S.-Saudi relations may look like moving forward. What will the longer-term consequences be for U.S.-Saudi relations of the brutal repression and many other issues that we've discussed today? We believe that these forward-looking questions are extraordinarily important. We also recognize that the answers to some of these forward-looking questions depend on a number of factors that remain unknown at present. One very obvious such factor is the outcome of our own elections here in the United States just over a month away. As such, we envision today's virtual conference as the first of a pair of events that we will be putting on this fall, focused on Saudi Arabia, with the second event to come after the results of the U.S. Election are known. That event will focus much more heavily on the U.S.-Saudi relationship and examine how that relationship might evolve moving forward, either under a Biden administration or during a second Trump term. So please stay tuned via our website, our social media, or our email lists for forthcoming details on that follow-up event. Finally, I'd just like to thank once again all of our really excellent speakers for participating today. I'd also like to thank our outstanding staff here at POMED for all of their hard work to put on this event. This is a team effort that contributed to by many members of our staff. I want to particularly thank our communications team, April Brady and Claire Ulmer, for the really outstanding work that they've done in coordinating this event and making it a success. And finally, thanks to all of you from the audience for joining us today. We very much look forward to staying in touch with you as we continue to explore these issues. Thanks.